All right, what is up, everybody? Zombies here again, and we are back with another episode of the Fighting Pit Podcast. I am joined, as always, by my two co-hosts, Wizard Beast and Mullahoo. How are you guys doing tonight?
Doing great. Very excited for this massive drop and everything, and excited to get into it.
Yes, oh, yeah. No, super excited, sleepy, but excited, and so we're ready to take on a new format with kind of talking about literally twice, more than twice as many mm-hmm. new mercs that we've ever seen before.
Like three and times, so gonna, basically. Yeah, it's ludicrous. A ton. So we, you know,
basically about what we called. We yeah. said what we basically said,
said
between 15 to 20.
Yeah, we were pretty on the money. Like, so we got, I think it was 18 total, like ton of mercenaries. So. We're going to be talking about those before we dive into everything. If you enjoy this show, help us out a ton. If you're watching on YouTube, hit the little like and subscribe or follow us on any of the podcasting platforms. Little thing, but it does help the show out a ton. So getting right on into it. Before we get into the mercenaries, we do have a few other short things to cover. Still mercenary stuff, but not the characters themselves. So first of all, N'Zoth will now be available through normal acquisition means. The N'Zoth event is over. Also, we are recording this the day of the patch notes. So all this information is still super new, super fresh, and we have not gotten to play with the characters yet, but I'm sure that will change as the week goes on. But some things they change. So N'Zoth available, usual stuff there. This one's pretty big. You can now borrow a party from your opponent in a mercenaries friendly challenge. That's like, I know we were asking for this a little while ago, but this is a huge, huge thing. Like now, if you have a friend who plays this game, you can actually like test stuff with them a lot easier if they don't have a fully leveled up account. Or, I mean, this is what I did with my friend in regular Hearthstone who was just starting and was new. He didn't know what he liked to play, and I have whaled out on Hearthstone over the last 8 years, so I have all these decks, and I'm just like, here, we can play some games, and I'll let you try all these decks, and you find something you like, and that way you don't have to commit your valuable dust until you know you're going to have fun with your deck, and you can do something similar in Mercenaries now. If you have a buddy who's pretty into it, or you want to get a friend into it, you can give them a chance of trying out all this cool stuff before you actually commit the X amount of hours to leveling a character, right? So big W there. Also huge for future cross-regional tournaments. You know, now, in theory, if you have just, let's say, 4 NA players and 4 EU players, as long as 4 players on one of those servers have the characters needed, you can literally do a cross-regional server or tournament now. So, like, that's huge. Like, that was a big barrier to entry in the tournament scene, and it's why the tournaments have been separated, North America and Europe, because no one's doing this grind twice. No one in their right mind is doing it twice. So that's huge. Like, and I would not be surprised if in the future we do see and we try and do our own little cross-server thing, because there are a lot of great players, especially on EU, that I would love a chance to play against. So, big
just getting the W. You need a physical. Like, you would literally not be able to play against these people. Like, mm-hmm. that's so cool to be able to cross the pond like that. Like, to yeah. you would literally not know what it's like to play against whatever, like Frankie or whatever, etc. Mm-hmm. Like, or just the people that you've seen, other content people. So, I literally missed it in the patch notes. I didn't even see this part until you realized it and told me earlier today. This mm-hmm. is a big quality of life upgrade, I think, that we don't even understand the boons of yet.
Yeah, it's like just it seems so, and I'm sure, you know, not everyone's going to experience that full, like, oh, this is awesome feature, but it's just so good to have for, like, basically the reasons we just talked about. Like, it's much rather have this than not. No reason not to have it. Glad we do have it. I think it snuck its way in early because it's mentioned in the patch notes, but I actually noticed this, I think, during the popper open that there was a button, and I had someone else in chat actually mention it to me, and they were doing that, and it worked. So I think it might have slipped in a little early, but it didn't make it into the patch notes. Yeah, but it was not. It was definitely not a thing since the beginning. It's definitely, it has to have been a more recent thing, because we would have noticed that long ago. But another feature, small thing, but you can now copy a mercenary's party to build a new party. So we are one step closer to exporting mercenaries deck lists and team comps and stuff. Not there quite yet, but if you have one you want to kind of iterate on without changing the build, now you got a little bit easier way to do that. So, small quality of life thing there. And then this is probably the biggest thing for the kind of general updates. So a new option has been added to the mystery nodes on the heroic bounty maps. Whenever you land on a mystery treasure node, you'll get additional rewards if you successfully complete the bounty. But beware, much of that treasure is cursed and will hinder your characters throughout the rest of your run. However, every once in a while, your mystery treasure will turn out to be straight bonus rewards. All the additional prizes at the end of your bounty without the added curse. So are you feeling lucky? So I think we'll have to experience this in-game before we get a full idea, but it sounds like it's going to be limited to heroic bounty maps, and now there's another option with the mystery node. So now we can get a treasure node from there, and you know, we've been talking about for a while more like ways to make heroics matter a little bit more and just make the rewards a bit better for putting that extra time in. And I don't know if this is 100% the everything we need in terms of like that. Like, I'm sure there's still other things that can be done there, but I'd rather have it than not. So we'll take what we can get at this point. Anything that makes it just some way to get a little bit more out of the time you're spending in a bounty, especially a harder bounty, definitely a good thing.
Yeah, so, I think it's just a step in the right direction, basically. Mm-hmm. I think they're kind of like also testing it out with this, because, you know, it's not like on every single bounty, it's only if we choose to do it.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it's also good for the people who don't want to do this and want to do it normally. You know, you can just go around it. So where if this one's like, hey, as in before, where we were always hunting for the strangers to get all the tasks, now this one, it'll have a very high chance, so we can probably run through and just, you know, have to see what are the rewards that we will get from this. You know, is it worth it, the extra time that's making it harder, because we do have to complete the bounty. So we'll just have to definitely play it a lot and just see how it goes.
Definitely.
Yeah, I think it may not even really be a choice. Like, I don't think it'll be much of a choice in that sense, that this feels like it's only just great further incentivizing you to go and try to jam on the mystery node. Like, mm-hmm. I don't think you'll be able to know what the information is until you actually just flip it over and see if
like the potato. Right? Yeah.
Yeah. It's like potato, sabotage, mystery stranger, and now the
treasure
like,
node.
Funky,
yeah.
Like debilitative treasure. Yeah. It's like cash and treasure kind of thing like that. But no, again, yeah. Same thing. It's cool. It's we take those, and there's a world where it gives you like a lot of coins, right? Like a kind of goofy amount where it's mm-hmm. actually like, now there's stakes. Like, now if I mess up, like, I'm actually legitimately mad at myself that I messed up. Mm-hmm. Or it's like you complete it and you get like several hundred coins or something, where that saves you, like literally physically saves you 10, 20, 15, 30, 40 minutes. Like, that'd
totally be huge.
Worth it. So this has a potential to be the kind of the solution of the time, not necessarily the fun or enjoyment of the grind, but mm-hmm. it might make it just strictly faster on like a pure speed run it.
I mean, yeah, I would even like it too if it is like challenging, like if these cursed like treasures are actually very hard. It's like, oh, I want to keep going for this because I know the bonus is so big. It's like, hey, if I have to take this 3 or 4 times, but it's still worth it in time wise to do it, mm-hmm. and it's actually more fun because it's challenging, I would be totally up for that.
100% agreed. Like, that's kind of the biggest problem with heroics and why most people don't do them is because they take longer, your risk of failure is higher, and there's really not much you're gaining for that. In some cases, because of how the kind of weird coin distribution can work, sometimes it can even be worse depending on the coins you're going for, if you're going for those lower rarity coins. So anything to kind of give you that chance of, hey, I could get, you know, it's going to be harder to complete this, but I might get, you know, a fat stack of coins at the end of it. Like, we talked about that like numerous times in the past. And mm-hmm. I think it's like Malhu said, step in the right direction. You know, it's not the be all end all, but rather have it than not. Anything that helps us get coins and kind of adds a little bit of a interesting dynamic element to the gameplay is a good thing for the game. So we take those. We do also want to mention, shout out here to Alkali, the community manager of Hearthstone. Been in that role for a little while now, been doing a very good job at it. And she definitely, especially in my opinion, over this weekend, really turned this Mercs reveal stuff around. Because if you missed all the the talk on Twitter and various other social media places, people, myself included, were not the most pleased that when we finally got the little thing on, I think it was last Friday, for the mini set, we didn't even get like a line of text mentioning the big mercenary stuff. And I think that kind of deflated the wind in a lot of people's sails, like who were excited about this, because like they were like, oh, Mercs is going to have its own moment and all this stuff. And that's what they said at the beginning of the year, why they were changing this. And then it's like, well, now if Mercs is always coming on point four, it's always going to be overshadowed by the mini set. And obviously, regular traditional Hearthstone has a much larger audience than Mercenaries does at the moment. That's just pretty much indisputable fact. So it's understandable why they want to focus on the mini set. I get it. But like, especially because of the wording they used at the beginning of the year saying like they wanted Mercs to have its own time in the sun as like a major mode, like an expansion release, basically, because that's basically what this is. Like they changed it from monthly to more expansion cycle like. And so it's like when they are making that change, I think there are a lot of expectations that come with that, because the game, especially with the Trigor meta, has been less than great in the last 2 months, to say the least, when it comes to PvP and whatnot. So it's people were already kind of like expecting a lot from this patch. And basically, when it seemed like they weren't doing anything to kind of get people excited about it, I think it made a lot of people worried that there really wasn't going to be much of substance to this patch. And clearly, that's not the case. Obviously, we didn't get a million and one quality of life features or anything like that. But personally, I wasn't really expecting that. Everything I've heard, and especially some of the comments Alkali has made in response to people asking questions about this, you know, they have something. It sounds like they have something big in the pipeline plan for Mercenaries. But this first big drop is not when all of that quality of life stuff. And I know another thing a bunch of people brought up was creator reveals and stuff, how people wanted to see more of that type of stuff, because no reveals were planned. And basically they confirmed, yeah, the Merc stuff is still happening, but they basically had no other initial plans to do any kind of preview stuff for it. And the feedback was most certainly heard, because I was actually surprised by how many other people were upset by this. I didn't think there were that many of us. But there were a lot of people upset about this, and I mean I did a whole video about it. I was pissed off. I was like, that was the most mad I've been about something in Mercenaries in a long time. And one of the things I said in that video was basically like, actions speak a lot louder than words, because we've been getting words that haven't really meant a whole lot throughout most of the life cycle of this game for the past 8 months. So like, actions definitely speak a lot louder, because we've gotten a lot less of those. And she definitely, and this was also important to add, on a holiday weekend, right? Like, this is definably, this all happened at like late afternoon on Friday something. It's Memorial Day here in the US, so it's like a whole holiday weekend. And but she decided to do some fun little previews showing off the kind of little gifs of the characters and their portraits in the Mercenaries Discord. So that on its own was awesome. Like, I got to see, like, literally there were, I think, hundreds of people joined the Discord over the weekend. Like, huge amounts of people joined the Discord. I'll have the link to that in the description.
Where, how did they find this? How are people finding these Discord links?
She tweeted it out.
There was like a really she directly tweeted I'm trolling.
Yeah, she tweeted out and whatnot, so that helped people find it, and then more people kind of were coming in, and she did, like, multiple reveals over 3 days. I think it was, like, Saturday, Sunday, and Monday, and she didn't have to do any of this. And frankly, as someone who has been with Hearthstone as a game for a very long period of time, I would bet everything on the fact that if she was not there, this never would have happened. I've seen huge community backlash, way, way, way bigger than anything that's ever happened in Mercenaries, and zero response to that before. So, like, at least in my opinion, this is a very, you know, like, this would not have happened without her taking the time to say, hey, yeah, like, I understand why these people are upset, and I want to do something nice for them. So I think a little bit of that goes a really, really long way, especially in this community where we've been pretty starved for any kind of direct communication for a while in a lot of respects. So just big props to her and doing something cool like that. And she even figured out a last minute card reveal thing for Old Guardian. So basically he got to reveal all six Nagas. So that was awesome. Old Guardian, the PvP goat. I'm sure he's going to have some really great guides up very soon. So definitely they're probably out now, right? Yeah. But they're probably out by now since this is coming out on Saturday. But yeah, so big shout out to her for doing all that stuff. And other comments she mentioned, it sounds like they do want to get more creators and stuff involved, probably for the next time around when they have more of those, hopefully community, they're not community, but like quality of life stuff, stuff that the community's been wanting to see for a while now, the extra coin stuff, PvE endgame. I feel like I would be very surprised if that's not the type of stuff that comes in the next drop, because it's right around the year anniversary for Mercenaries. And literally she mentioned, and this is very recently, I'm not referring to the, you know, what they said at the beginning of the year, Mercs is going to have its big moment. There's a ton of content in this one, but this isn't the big moment for it yet, but it is coming. It's coming this year. And we've kind of speculated about this a bunch, like the mode needs fixes if you want to draw in a wider audience. And clearly, and we're going to talk about these mercenaries here shortly, the selection of mercenaries is drawing in, it's drawing back players who have previously stopped playing the game from what I've seen. And I would be very, very surprised if it doesn't draw in new players. The events have been very successful about that. And it, that might seem kind of surprising to some people, but especially with the revamp, they revamped how the bounties unlock. So now you just need to finish Winter Spring and you have access to all the bounties. I've had like 5 or 10 different people tell me that changed everything in terms of them wanting to mess around with the mode, because they could actually go and pick and choose and not just have to go through every bounty. If you get stuck on one, you have to repeat it a bunch and you can't progress. And or if you're going for heroic equipments for specific characters, like that's a huge, huge change for a player who is not like near the end game of leveled most of their stuff. So big accessibility thing there. They added that, I think, last patch, but really, really huge thing there for events, and events just seem to be bringing people back to the mode. And all these characters, we got the League of Explorers, we got a bunch of Nagas, we got other iconic characters like Lorewalker, Cho, Maeve, Shadow Song. Like there's so many like cool characters. I don't think I could have picked a cooler list if I tried, but no, we'll rip the Band-Aid off though for our fish friends. No Murlocs, surprisingly.
No Finley yet.
There is, I would be hugely surprised if we don't end up seeing Finley. I still think he's going to be an event mercenary. And one of the texts I think we were talking about before the show on Reno actually mentions explorers rather than just the other characters by name, whereas Bran and Elise mention Reno and Bran by name and whatnot. This one says explorers specifically. So I think it's going to be like Horde and Alliance, where it's a character trait of the card, but it's kind of like a hidden thing. It's not their type or subtype or whatever. So that's just cool little thing there. We do have some bounties, which we'll talk about. We don't know a lot about them yet, but we are getting three more bounties in the Dark Shore. And then we're going to be getting the Sunken City area with 10 bounties for the all new zone. Also, there is no Cal level. So for
we should at least talk about that a little bit because the ceiling for a Cal level being in this game is astronomical. Like for this game specifically, a Cal level could be huge. And so I'll take the little like spiel moment. What were you gonna say, Wizardbees?
For people who don't know what there is no Cal level, it's a reference to Diablo.
Diablo 2, yep.
In Diablo 2, basically, there was always kind of like little hints of like, oh, there is no Cal level, and like little things in the game kind of hinting at like cows and stuff, and this like secret level. And yeah, it's basically like a special portal that will take you to a faraway land where it's like just a ton of like cows, it's like monsters and stuff fighting.
Demonic cows.
So, Yeah, basically by them hinting there is no cow level, like that's what Blizzard would always say, and then people finally found the cow level. So it kind of matches, especially with Tyrael coming in, you know, another Diablo thing. So they're kind of like tying the universe in a little bit together.
Yeah, and so like the fact that it's just so specifically like a deep cut meme for a game from a really long time ago that like even people that play I guess it's still like a popular like famous phrase in that sense, but like it's not unheard of for you to like play Diablo or especially even like the newer Diablos and not really understand the
They do have a
reference or
cow
clearly
level
it's
now,
literally like
though,
20
in
years later and
D3.
that's cool, that's sick that they like and they made a meme one right like in Diablo 3 there was like
Yep.
the like inverted cow level where it's like
Whimsy
rainbow cow
Shire,
level
yep.
instead
And they
of right
added
and so
one to
like
D3 later. They actually
and that's
did put
sick
a cow
like
level in
a full-blown
D3.
cow level
Yeah.
yeah because and so it's just like the cow level is a very like famous spot but in particular it's really famous because it has it's a really 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 good like high EV place to farm
Oh, yeah.
and so in terms of a
Oh, I didn't
farming
even think of
game that
that.
mercenaries is
Didn't even
the
think of
things that they
that.
could do the things that they could theoretically do with the cow level in terms of literally a bounty that's either like very short with insanely high rewards because again the other big meme about the cow level was that there were a ton of cows all over the place, like huge, like as many monsters as you could possibly want on a screen at once. There were that many
True.
cows all over the place, but then there was one specific guy called the Cow King who was in the middle of the whole level. And if you killed him, he dropped the best loot table in the whole zone. But as soon as you killed him, that character was locked out from ever opening the Cow King portal again to the cow level. So people would circumvent that and try to not kill the Cow King or have
Yep.
another character open the portal, and then you would go in, kill the Cow King. You wouldn't lose credit because it was someone else's portal, and you cheese it like that. Like all these mechanics are very much so like you could totally tie them into mercenaries, whether it's like a funky like exploit cheese meme or a high farm zone meme, like crazy bounty coins or whatever it is. Really interesting that they're alluding to this and potentially very exciting.
Hell yeah. One thing that so far is my guess of how to somewhat get there is I bet it's going to be a cursed treasure or something on the new mysterious node.
Oh,
that'd be cool.
that could make
I bet
sense.
there's some tie through that where it's like, hey, it's a special treasure that doesn't say anything, and then you beat the bounty and then like goes to like another bounty or
That
something. I
makes
think
so
like
much
that'd be cool.
sense. That
That would be
makes
really
so
cool.
much sense. I didn't
That
even,
would be
yeah,
really cool.
that's a great point, both of you. Like I didn't even think about like all that. Those aspects, but yeah, the cow level was the spot to go, and like you tried to avoid killing the king. I've seen a bunch of people just go in, they're just killing the cows because
Yeah.
they don't
Like literally,
want
what
to
if
get
you
locked
like
out
have to
of
try to lose, like if you
it.
actually win the bounty, like it's a kind of a either a downside or like there's an upside for not beating it in a certain way. Like there's all kinds of memes that they could certainly very easily like 1-to-1 kind of like
Yeah,
put
because
into
it
this game. It's
fits,
really
right?
cool.
It's a farming game for leveling up your characters. Diablo is the same thing. So, you know, more to come on
We'll see.
that.
We'll see.
But
We'll see.
by
Who
the time
knows?
this comes out, maybe people have already found the cow level.
I'm sure we will. I'm sure we will.
So I'm really excited for all that. Just, and I mean, speaking of Diablo, I do want to get into the fact that we are getting another crossover, but we got to talk about this Yashiraj event. So we're getting another old god, and I think we're going to get all the old gods over the course of the events. And old gods are so cool. We saw with N'Zoth that they all have like kind of their own little theme and stuff. But I predicted this when we saw N'Zoth. His third ability has a really high cooldown, but he has another ability that reduces all your other old gods' abilities. So as soon as I saw that, I was like, all right, we're getting other old gods. And I figured most of them would have an ability where it's like, you have this big, powerful ability, but you have to get the cooldown. It's like kind of their big old god ultimate or whatever. But the cooldown's so large, you have to like, you can't just wait for it. Because with Yashiraj, his is 10. So if you're waiting for that, literally, if you're not messing with the cooldown at all, you're getting to fatigue before you can use that ability, which is crazy. But it's also a crazy ability. So, and we'll talk about the character. I think the way to do this. So I think we can fully just go through Yashiraj really quick because he's an event character. But for the rest of the mercenaries, since there are so many of them, we're going to be doing things a little bit different this time. Instead of reading every single thing from them, we are going to have a link in the description to the patch notes. We're going to be going in order so you can follow along with us. We're going to more be focusing on kind of our reactions to the characters because literally just reading all the text in here and spending like a minute or two on it, that's a good like 2 hours plus. And we want to talk about what we think about these characters rather than just like reading the patch notes aloud for you. Normally with the smaller ones, we'd read them all out, but they're 18 mercenaries and we got a lot to cover. So we're going to be doing things a little bit differently for this one. Yeah, I think it should be good, but let's dive into Yashiraj here though, since he is our event mercenary. So Yashiraj is a legendary protector, old god, 9 attack, 85 HP. So pretty bulky. And he is also a shadow user, which is cool. Someone pointed out that they could definitely have seen him being fell, and I could have seen that as well, but looks like he's joining the shadow gang. So first ability is Defiled Attack, shadow, speed 6, borrow 5 attack from all friendly characters this turn, attack an enemy, death blow, repeat this. Kind of similar to Zwen, right? Like a little bit different, but kind of the same in a lot of ways, but I think a little bit better, especially because the shadow too. Shadow has a lot of synergies and it's gaining a lot more during this set too. Yep. Then we have Strength of Yashiraj, shadow, speed 1, gain taunt and take 6 less damage this turn. Old God's abilities refresh 3. So much like N'Zoth, he has a way to kind of refresh other old gods and his own ability. And then the big ability, Rage Unbound, shadow, speed 2, cooldown 10, highest cooldown we've seen yet. Give all your characters plus 20 attack. They attack random enemies. So that's kind of insane. that's pretty nuts. All of your characters, that includes summons too, potentially, which we do know N'Zoth loves to make summons that don't take damage on attack. And then his equipment. Mark of Yashiraj, Defiled Attack borrows an extra 5, so it borrows 10 from all friendly characters. That could be huge. More combo with N'Zoth there too, potentially, because N'Zoth can make more characters for you to steal from. You don't care if you're stealing from N'Zoth because he's not physically attacking. So more synergy there. Heart of Yashiraj passive. Whenever this merc is attacked, gain plus 5 attack. So kind of a cool protector one, especially because he has a taunt ability. So you can kind of play into that, right? You can prepare your taunt if you have that and you get him really high up, which kind of fits because he was always the biggest of the old gods and his whole thing was like summoning big things. So really nailing the flavor. And Idol of Yashiraj, last equipment, Rage Unbound gives an extra 8 attack. So plus 28 attack. It's insane. Obviously at 10 cooldown, you want it to be insane, but it's not really 10 cooldown. Cause if we think about it, this is probably more of a bench mercenary, I would imagine. You benefit from that, passing the turns along. But if you get this and N'Zoth, then I think, does N'Zoth do 3 or 2? I think it's refresh 2. I think it's refresh a little 2. Bit less. Okay. 2, yeah. So
the question I have is, I wonder if the refresh, since it's 2 just old gods, if it works on the bench. Because technically we don't know yet, because we only have 1 old god in the game.
True.
So if you have to be on the bench,
but
or
maybe
if it would be in play.
I think
almost certainly isn't affecting the bench.
Yeah, I don't think it would affect the bench. I think that would probably be too good. It'd probably be too easy.
In this drop, they gave us a bunch of like the word bench shows true. Up a bunch of times. So they gave us the precedent that they will tell us bench if it goes benchy, and so I think it probably doesn't. I think it has to be like
play. Which makes sense. I think that definitely makes a lot of sense. But, you know, we're definitely going to get to that point once. I think they're going to do events for all the old gods, looking at the pattern so far. But can you just imagine like a 4 old god comp where you're just like using them all to like get their ultimate abilities down? And it's awesome.
That'd be really neat.
I really hope they do all 5 of them. Because
they
haven't shown, but there's also from WoW and one of the recent expansions, just the Blood God.
True.
Gahoon or whatever, yeah.
Yeah, he's.
So that'd be cool if they start having Malcolm in.
Wasn't he like a not man made, but like artificially created old god or something. I heard a little bit about that.
He was created from the old gods, basically, and he was artificially created by like one of the jailers that was supposed to stop the old gods.
Interesting.
Yeah, he's like a gigantic like blood worm, basically, that was like kind of burrowing in the,
that's
like,
cool.
The earth and stuff. So yeah. No, he actually really like him. He's really cool.
Here. Yeah. That could be in here. I have old gods and cookie. Ship it.
Cookie keeping them all alive.
He's the number one old gods fan.
Sixth old god.
Yeah. Yep. But this event is going from, it's not starting right away with the patch. It's starting a few days later. So it's starting on June 7th. And it is only going to June 21st. So just 2 weeks, a little bit shorter. I know the N'Zoth event, I think, was a little bit longer than usual. Yeah. Now we're back to that kind of 2 week thing. I do wonder if that means maybe we have another event down the line, if they're going to, now that we have this big release, if they're going to start doing more regular events to kind of pad out the time in between, which we've talked about as a good way to kind of introduce single mercs without doing like a whole big drop and stuff. But same structure as the prior events, they're going to be 10 special tasks. You're going to get 2 a day for the first 5 days, and then you can complete them whenever you want until the end of the event. And the rewards are very similar as before. You get the Yashiraj Mercenary, a random golden Yashiraj portrait, the diamond portrait, which looks amazing, by the way, and 750 total Mercenaries coins. That'll probably be a mix of his coins as well as some of the other recently released mercs. And the last little hint we had for this is humans and pirates will be your best allies for this event. So probably going to have some stuff involved with them. But we're getting some new pirates and some, at least one new human, I think maybe more, I'm not sure. At least one. But we already had a lot of humans. So definitely level those units, because by the time this comes out, the event will only be a few days away. It starts on Tuesday. So basically it's a week, just under a week after the patch hits. Mm-hmm. The event will be live, and I'll be doing some guides for that as usual, but I cannot wait. And like we said in the beginning, really huge here that 18 mercenaries in this new drop, 5 of them are legendary, 2 of them totally free, basically. You can get this Yashiraj one through the event, and we'll talk a little bit about the free mercenary here, Tyriel. So we were talking about Diablo. Well, we're getting our second Diablo crossover, and it is none other than the former Archangel of Justice, I believe, Tyriel. And he's coming in as a fighter. I cannot wait to try him out. He looks really cool. A bunch of holy skills and abilities. But maybe even the cooler part is that he is free for everybody. And you don't, unlike the event, you don't even have to do a task or anything. All you have to do is pop open the store and purchase the free thing, and you have him. So huge, huge. Like, I was worried that there were going to be too many legendaries in this big drop. I was worried, oh, we get 20 mercenaries. What if we get 5 or more legendaries? You know, some people, myself included, before have had bad luck where it took me 40, 50 packs to get a legendary. If there are 5 legendaries, that could be over 200 packs, which is crazy. And that's actually what I have right now is 200. But like, still, that's like, I did the math earlier. If you wanted to buy them in increments of 40, if you wanted to buy the regular priced thing, which I recommend nobody do outside of bundles. But if you wanted to buy regular Hearthstone pricing, that's like $250 or whatever.
Yeah.
Like, damn. Seriously. So I'm really happy that they decided to lighten the load on us a little bit in terms of legendaries. We have 3 that we can get in the packs, 1 from an event, and 1 that's just totally free for everybody. So really, really nice way of handling it, in my opinion. And I think it's gonna just be really good for the community, because that means, so 18 minus 5, we have 13 rares and epics. And can anyone say Pauper? Like, it's gonna
Pauper 3, maybe.
Oh yeah, it's gonna change Pauper a ton. We had the Pauper event last weekend. It was so much fun. It was a blast to cast the event. We had a bunch of great competitors, and by the time this goes up, it will be live on YouTube, so definitely check that out if you haven't. But big congrats to our competitors. Everyone who competed in the event did a great job. And we won't have to wait quite as long before we get to another Pauper event. I promise it won't be like 6+ months or something crazy. Mm-hmm. Especially with all this new cool stuff being added to the format like that. Because majority of these mercs are rare and epic, and I mean, I don't want to spoil anything before we start talking about them all here, but I, and maybe this is a bold claim, I think every mercenary in this drop has potential to see PvP play, which is not something I don't think I've felt that way about many drops at all in the past. There's usually at least one or two where I'm like, all right, this is a PvE player. Like, this is, I can run some bounties with this, but it's not going to be doing much for me in the fighting pit. But I honestly, looking at all the mercenaries we got, I haven't found one where I'm like, yeah, I don't really see it. Like, I think there's potential for everything. And that's out of almost 20 mercs, which is absolutely nuts. So I think we want to just dive right into it. Like I said, we're going to be doing this in a little bit different format. So we are going to be going in order. So if you want to open up the patch notes, you can follow along with us. But we're not going to be reading them all out. We're basically going to just talk a little bit about what we like about the character, and we're going to give them a number rating off of how good we think they are on a scale of 1 to 5. And then once we get through all the characters, we'll spend a little bit of time talking about some possible theory craft builds that we put together. So we're going to start off with Tyrael here. Who here is the biggest Diablo fan among us?
Probably me.
I would say so. You played D2 when it was like before the remaster, so I think
I played it in Tyrael. I'm honestly, I'm very excited to get Tyrael like this. And so in terms of our like numbers going across the board, I would put Tyrael at a 4 at least.
Mm-hmm.
Like 4.5, like kind of nuts considering it's a free merc.
Yeah. He's looking pretty good, and I don't know about you, but by far, well, one, he is some very much needed holy support. The holy comp really hasn't had a whole lot going for it, especially in the green slot. Tyrael just got an upgrade actually, which will help him with this, where his first skill is a holy ability now, but all of Tyrael's, and that's going to get confusing, Tyrael and Tyrael, but all of Tyrael's abilities are holy, and they're very oriented about holy combo. All three of them have holy combo. So you want to be playing Tyrael in a holy build, or Tyrael in a holy build. See, I already did it. so you want to be playing him in a build. Yeah, go ahead.
I think we, it doesn't say in the patch notes at least, but I think he's a human. Which, like,
he is not.
His base skin is a human. Ooh, okay.
Confirmed. So no type. He is now.
That's a big deal. No type.
Okay. The only merc with no type previously. Gruul had that honor, but little inside information here, which will be out by the time the patch is out. But Gruul is getting a type. He is getting a Gron type, which, if you're like me, I had no idea what a Gron is. Apparently, it's like related. It's like, what, like
Gruul.
It's what like the orcs originally like turned into, came from, kind of
like their home world and everything.
Yeah.
Ancestral orcs.
Exactly. Ancestral orcs. That's a good way of putting it. So he gets a type, Tyrael doesn't get one. And basically that's because for any non-lore people, he's technically a Nephilim, not a human, I believe is the reasoning there. Though he like, I thought he might've been a human, but no, he, no type.
I'm not sure if that's good.
I thought he was human. Not Nephilim.
I think he.
Nephilim is what the player plays.
Correct, but yeah. I think it was brought up somewhere that like he had more than human abilities. He just wasn't an angel. So I think he did fall into the Nephilim category. I'm not that versed on the Diablo lore, but yeah. I thought the same thing. I was like, oh, he crashed Earth. Maybe we'll get him as a human, but confirmed, no human typing, no typing at all. So no plus or minus there. I think, at least to me though, the ability that stands out the most is that that middle ability where you're dealing 10 to an enemy, holy combo, freeze them. And no cooldown on that. A little slower at 5 speed, but you have ways of speeding that up. And is this the first time we're seeing no, it's not the first time we're seeing freeze outside of like Frost. We had Drekthar.
Yeah, Drekthar and Belinda are the only other two that can, I think, freeze turn one.
It was a new thing, for sure, outside the tribe, at least. Like, I guess Drekthar was a little bit outside it, but I think this is going to see a lot more play than Drekthar did.
Can I spoil the, like, literally, I feel like you have to spoil the Holy Freeze comp, because literally I didn't even start thinking about comp building stuff like that yet, but this this comp of Zarella, Valyra, and Tyrion. You just go
Tyrael.
Shrink a dude. I mean, sorry.
It's so easy.
You literally shrink somebody's attack. You punch someone for a million, and you freeze at one speed. Like, that's just such an insanely stifling opener.
Every turn.
That basically all of the upside of the Belinda comp, but with none of the doubt. Like, that happened once.
Yeah, like, it doesn't go away like the elemental. The
Valyra stuff. It was one turn of freeze. Your opponent played around it, killed your thing, and then you continued to play. But now you just get to freeze. It's just straight up turn off a character and do damage to them every time. Yep. That's
and then you could also
so
make
good.
It so you're not taking basically retaliation damage with, you know, making it so they have less damage with Zarella. So
mm-hmm. And it's just like a straight heal on Zarella too that you can put at zero speed and it still mm-hmm. triggers the holy combo. Like,
and that, it triggers really the Lyra combo. And it's just, it's looking really spicy. I think it's going to be a very strong build. But
Ragnaros.
Yeah, not even just Ragnaros. Other characters we haven't even gotten close to talking about yet. There are some kind of checks in place for more counters to things being frozen, which is great if you're going to make a character like this exist, because as we've seen before, perma-freezing things can get really annoying if you're not the one doing it. So I do like that they are doing something different like this. Actually kind of shocked that this doesn't have at least a one cooldown, but I think that's because of some of the other like kind of counter freeze stuff that has been implemented in this same patch. But in terms of number, Mulhu has given Tyrael that 4, 4.5. I think same kind of boat, at least a 4. Like, I think this character gives you a reason to play a holy build. Like, previously, if you were memeing, sure. But, like, there was no reason to really play any of the holy characters specifically for their holy synergy. And now it matters having holy abilities because you want to holy combo all of these abilities. It is always a positive, basically. So you want to be having reason. And all his abilities are 5 speed. I wonder if that's kind of like a funny nod to like how Diablo is 6-6-6. They just gave him 3 5s.
Oh, no. Yeah, honestly, probably. I didn't even notice that, but that's probably a good point. No, I like it. And I think it finally also really maybe like or is like a final
mm-hmm.
sentiment. Because, yeah, if we do this much talking for every character,
we're never going to get through it. Yeah.
Tyrael, I think maybe it's almost like the ones that are in, like, I had Tyrael, honestly, one of my like quick top 5 for the whole list of new mercs. So I think we can probably talk about the ones that we have in those like top tier positions, maybe a little more. But no, I think most importantly or also importantly, we finally now have another merc that you want to copy spells with Velen from.
Yes.
Really struggled to only have Anduin and Velen. And if Anduin died, Velen was just a brick. You didn't care about a single of the other characters. You weren't playing Uther. They were like cheeky holy combos. But now we finally have a second merc to be able to play like bench Velen. Or you could literally just open Velen, Tyrael,
Cornelius,
Anduin if you want. Or Cornelius. Like, there's all kinds of stuff in there now. And being able to have another slow Velen copy my next holy spell combo is really sweet. So definitely
cool. I think I would give him a 4. And also how you're mentioning Velen, if you double his last ability, your other friendly characters will take 10 less damage
next turn
twice. So it would be 20 less damage. They basically just can't be damaged the following turn.
Yeah,
damn.
So yeah, I think I'm giving him a solid 4. I think he's gonna be pretty strong.
Yeah,
simply free.
Yeah, free in every sense of the word.
And I love his diamond too.
Oh yeah, his diamond is absolutely sick.
And also mentioning about him free, because there was kind of that incident with Vandar, is make sure you do grab him before opening packs, because before, with the quest, how Vandar was free when you did the quest line, people would be opening packs.
True.
And that even happened to me. I opened packs, got Vandar, and then did the quest, and it kind of like ruined it in a way, like didn't get the exact reward that I should have got. So make sure, you know, second login game, grab him before you start opening your packs, because you don't want to.
Because he's in the pack pool.
Legendary and get him.
Because his portraits are, and his coins should be.
Yep.
He's not like the event, so he will be in the pack pool. Unfortunately, the difference in time of when this is coming out, people have probably opened their packs.
Oh,
but I'll maybe I'll send out a little tweet in the morning or something warning
people.
For anyone
who hasn't opened packs with the time.
Yeah.
And especially when talk about probably one of the biggest deltas of base skin to even just the next skin up in terms of like his base skin is like probably the one you get for free is
boring
human dude, and then it's like super sick angel Tyrael guy, like it's just the next skin. Like you really want to get a skin for Tyrael if you want to be playing him, like probably more than any other Merc I've seen so far.
It's so
and
cool.
Diamond riding on his judgment horse.
Yeah,
it's great.
It's I'm very excited for it. Maybe someday we'll get a little bit more crossover stuff. You know, maybe play Diablo Immortal, get a Tyrael portrait or something. But unfortunately, not yet. Even though that's dropping like a day after the patch, but we'll take it. Free stuff, big W, and especially for a character that's looking very powerful. But yeah, we're not going to spend like crazy amount of time on all the characters. This one is worth a little bit of words, though.
Still words, yeah.
Yeah, Queen Ashara, legendary caster. Oh, man. Like, so we got Nagas. I think it's worth mentioning just there are 6 Nagas coming. If you didn't check it out, Old Guardian did a cool reveal for the Nagas with all their abilities and stuff. But Nagas are such a cool tribe, and I think we can kind of talk about almost like all of them at once a little bit in that they have different spell schools. Like they're not, it's not all fire or shadow or arcane or whatever. It's every Naga. Some have like similar ones. Like there's a lot of shadow throughout, but there's also like the queen has arcane. The next one down has frost and shadow. Then one of them has nature. So they're kind of all over the place in terms of what tribes they support, which I think is an awesome thing. Cause you're going to get more mix and matched builds, but they also have synergy with each other. Like the queen herself, and I think this is one of the craziest abilities we've ever seen in mercenaries, the +1/+6 she gets. So she has a passive equipment +1
all of her equipment is
every ability on this character is bananas, but the equipment in specific, if you're running a Naga build or if Naga's become a meta thing, this merc gets +1/+6 for each Naga in play or on your bench. So just thinking about that for a second, if you build a 6 Naga comp, one, it counts itself. So boom, 6 Nagas right there potentially. And then it counts ones in play on your opponent's side. Also counts summons.
Wait.
And there are a lot of Naga summons.
Counting your opponent. It does count your opponents?
Not their bench, but the ones in play.
Right.
So this can get really, really big. Also, in the GIF they revealed it with, it was max 77 health. That's actually not true. It's max 83 health.
Whoa, jeez.
Yeah. So if we do a little bit of math here, it is very, very easy if you're building a Naga build to have a huge queen, which is awesome and very thematic. But since this is a passive, as those Nagas go away, those stats go away. It's not a battle cry. So
yeah, I like that they did more of this. Like there are a couple other characters that have this like passive, like reflecting the game state, like stat changing. I definitely think it's a cool direction. I'm glad they're doing it.
It's really cool. And I mean, we could probably do like literally almost a whole episode just on the Nagas themselves, but the queen by far has, I think a lot of the Nagas are good. I don't think any of the Nagas are like bad at all. I think they will all see play in different stuff, but the biggest thing I love about them is it just gives me such more reason to try weird things. Like the queen is arcane, so maybe I'll try her in a build with Tyrande and Longjin and stuff. Like you can, the potential for comps is never, it's just never been higher than what we're getting with this, in my opinion, because we have so many new playable, like PvP playable characters making their way in. Like I brought up this comparison on stream. There's 70 or there are almost 80 characters in mercenaries right now. There'll be just under 100 when this comes out. So that's a 20% increase. Think about how many of those 79 characters see play in PvP. Maybe a quarter. Maybe a quarter-ish, right? I think that's kind of reasonable, like 25-ish, you know, at least in the higher ranks. So if that's true, if all of these mercenaries are playable, it's kind of close to like 40-ish percent of new mercenaries of the playable field, and maybe it'll make some old things that weren't playable, like Holy, maybe it'll make that work. So I love Nagas are a slam dunk. I was wondering how they were going to do it in Mercenaries. They did unique stuff in Constructed. They did unique stuff in Battlegrounds, and they did the same in Mercs. And in my opinion, slam dunk. Like, just power level queen. I think it's one of the strongest cards of the set. I'd say at least like 4.5, like if not a 5. Like, I think this is one of the most busted characters of the whole drop. I think she has just insane potential.
So I'm actually a little bit on the opposite scale. I think compared to other Nagas, I think she's actually weaker.
Really?
For at least, yeah, like everything seems good firsthand. Like, oh yeah, you can get more stats and stuff from passives, and her abilities can seem good. But I feel like it's not enough where it's like, oh my god, she's like the carry, as like, say, like a local R.
Interesting
and stuff.
Oh, yeah, so I mean, she's definitely not a carry in that sense. Like,
oh, I think she could be.
I mean, she scales like crazy. Like, she just has the like built-in scaling like that. So I think she can like become a carry in that way.
One.
Yeah, I just feel like because some of her things are like where it lasts like this turn where she has like resistance stuff or like gain the spell damage. You're using a whole turn for that. And yeah, if they have, you know, like a big combo or something and you could stop it, then it's worth it.
Yeah, but it's just a read, like a counter spell.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so it's kind of like you have to predict it in certain things, but otherwise I'm actually going to give her like a 2.5.
Really?
I would also give it probably a 4 to a 4.5. She also just has the like Ankh, like reincarnation passive.
True.
Like a Cairn reincarnation passive and a Malfurion equipment potentially.
Shadow
like,
Malph, basically, yeah.
Yeah, like yeah. The fact that she has three
Shadow
like,
Malph
really
healing.
Nutty equipment. And like Zombies was saying, like the fact that it can go into Arcane, it can go into Shadow, it can go into Nagas, it can go into none of the above, it can go into weird, like crazy dragon arcane thing. Like, I think she can go all over the place. And the fact that she even has more health than the number shows is really crazy. yeah, I had her in my like quick top five list. I think she's one of the better, because I think mostly because I'm not very high on a lot of the other Naga.
Really?
I have like two or three of the other Naga quite low. So that's funny that we're splitting the votes here. I like it.
And last thing we'll say about her before we move on. She is introducing basically something we've never seen before, which is flat up plus just plus spell damage. Effectively, like her first ability scales off of cares about multiple spell schools, which is super cool on its own. So it encourages that diverse team building, but she has just flat gain plus 3 spell damage. Like we've never seen that before in Mercenaries, where it just gives a flat plus 3 to every type of spell. And in theory, this actually could even buff spells without types, because they're still spells. They just don't have
funny.
A type. Someone yeah, brought that up weird. On stream, and I think it works in regular Hearthstone. Probably will work in Merc. So cool seeing a across the board like spell increase, spell damage increase, and it's very fitting for the queen. So we'll move on to our the next one, Zajara, the Sea Witch. So another caster mercenary or caster Naga. So I believe it's 2-2-2. So two casters, two fighters, two protectors. So Nagas are nice and evenly distributed. This one focusing more on Shadow and Frost. This is the character we alluded to at the beginning with there's a little bit of anti-freezing stuff here, which I really, really like. Specifically, they're passive. Whenever a friendly character is frozen, freeze a random enemy. So it's like, you freeze me, I freeze you. it's not the world's best freeze counter. You also get 20 health on top of it, which you're never sad to see.
Yeah, I don't think I saw that before.
Yeah, so that's helpful. And then they have their own freeze ability where you can freeze a character, even your own if you want, and make them immune while frozen. And then when they lose frozen, an AoE happens to the enemies. So really interesting stuff here. They also have some summons and whatnot. And this is the character that can, if you're slower than whatever you're attacking, you permanently have the target's attack rounded up. I'm curious how that works, if that's like a continuous debuff, or if it just halves it at the time, because I don't know. But
I think it's continuous.
I think it's continuous, because it says
worded
I would,
permanently.
I would guess it's probably honestly not continuous. I think it's a sticker.
Mm-hmm.
And then if it ever gets buffed, it probably just buffs flat from that.
From like the base, yeah.
That's my guess. So it's funny again that we're splitting the... we don't know how it works, I guess, in that way. But yeah, if I'd be surprised if it was like readjusting based on any other thing. But again, I mean, maybe it's not impossible for sure. Like, it's a curse on purpose, so...
I mean, I think this character's cool. I don't think she's nearly as strong as the queen, but that's kind of a high bar. If I had to pick a number, I'm putting this one in like the kind of 2.5-3 middle of the road. Like, I think it'll see play, but I don't think it's a like the highest power of the stuff we've seen so far.
I'm gonna go a little opposite. I'm gonna go 4.5 on her.
Mm.
I think she is very strong, especially with that second skill. And also with it being frost, it does get plus frost damage. So if you freeze your own person,
yeah,
end of turn, which will go after every other person. So if you have a local on your team, that's plus 12 damage. That's 22 damage to all enemies at the end of your turn.
Does Localar's thing keep at end of turn?
Well, I mean, her thing doesn't say end of turn, and normally frozen ends before end of turn because
Sinestra then
goes
yeah
after that.
Yep, so it would be before end of turn, which should, is important.
Yeah, because it's technically Sinestra always goes normally after the unfreeze.
Yeah.
And that's like the
end that's of turn end effect. Of turn. Yeah.
So that's when all of the debuffs from the turn should be going off. So, I mean, we don't know yet, but I'm pretty sure that's how it works. So if you do that would be 22 damage to everything without crits. And then you also get to save one of your characters, basically. So having them go immune.
Yeah,
so
making
I'm
him immune.
Thinking
yeah.
that just, yeah, one ability right there is very strong. And especially you take the equipment, then you also get to freeze another enemy and have plus 20 health. So I'm giving her a 4.5. I think she can be very strong in Frost.
What do you think, Malhu?
I had her as pretty low to begin with, but I think when people are going to be really thirsty for the full Naga comp in the sense that, yeah, I think the only good part about her entire kit is just her second ability. I actually don't really like any of her equipment.
Okay.
And even the fact that like whenever a friendly character is frozen, like we were talking about with like the, crazy like Zarella, just again, for the, like the stupid example, Valyra still lets you freeze faster than this matters. Like your whole team will act, you'll freeze something, she'll then freeze at random, but it won't do anything.
Yeah.
So like those kind of like feels bad like Valyra cheese.
Those
but,
it won't fix.
Right. But no, I think Wizard Beast definitely sold me a little bit more on the second ability targeting your own dude. Again, are you ever gonna have a Localar in play while you have her in play casting Freezing Touch? I don't know.
Maybe off the bench, maybe right?
Off the bench.
Yeah, like a swap.
That means you have both of these. Like that means you have like Localar on the bench and her on the bench, which like maybe it's not impossible.
Or like Frost Lead, right?
Or
like make them
like
pick
the
off Jaina or Localar and then swap in. But yeah, I could see what you're saying. It could be a little hard to line up sometimes.
Yeah, I'm just a little spooked of it, but I think I will bring it up to I'll say it's a. I'll give it a like a speculative 3.5 because I do think that second ability is really good. So I'll put her in like mid high range.
Okay. And the item was one thing I forgot. It was on this character. I did want to mention super quick. Basically, inverse Vol'jin. Shadow abilities are 4 speed slower passive. I think that's insane. Especially when Nagas care about going slow. So you're kind of okay slowing down your shadow abilities because you want them to be having... You want them to be slower, like even her own ability. If it's already acted, you want to be going second because otherwise you don't permanently half the attack. So some of these Nagas want to go slow and benefit the queen especially. So not only can you screw up your opponent's Vol'jin so they can't throw it off the bench, have a speedy Vol'jin Kazakus, now they're slower and the slow is benefiting you if you have shadow units. Unless you run Vol'jin, but you probably wouldn't want to run Vol'jin in this build unless you're doing something weird with it. But I thought that was super cool. Like we need more of that. And that's why I think this whole drop is giving us speed has always been the name of the game. We're finally getting some, I'm not going to say trick room effects, but like basically a reason to go slow. Like that isn't just like that has reasonable payoff because before it was, you go fast and going fast is better because you kill things or you deny your opponent and dealing more damage didn't matter if you were slow because you were just dead. But yeah, so that is our second Naga of the bunch. Moving right along, our first red Naga, Phantom Lord Karathes. So this one is more of a like a physical and kind of summon focused Naga. They don't actually have any spell schools, it seems, which is very unusual compared to the other Nagas. I think all the other ones have at least one spell school, if not two. So this one, a little bit more physical and summon focused, but that's definitely cool. And so for me, for this one, I like it, but I think it's definitely one of the Naga. I think the Naga I'm probably lowest on, just because I think the only the best thing about it is how it has this ability where you can buff up itself for each friendly Naga, and an equipment can make that happen to all your Nagas, but you have way more cooldown. So that could be cool, and if you have a Naga theme. But other than that, I'm not really... I think this one makes sense less in pure Naga comps. And I'm not really sure... Like, I think its abilities are fine, but I'm not sure where it finds a home yet. So I probably rate this as one of the lower Nagas. I'll give it a 2. I don't think it's terrible. I think it's possibly playable, but I'm not as impressed compared to like some of the other Nagas.
Yeah, I'm exactly the same with you on that. I'm right at a 2. I don't think, you know, it's not terrible. I think it can see play, especially if Nagas, you know, with the Queen, how she does have that passive of having more Nagas, and also the first ability allows you summon a Naga, and if you combo with Frost, you get another one. So right there, there'd be two Nagas. So I think you can see play, but out of all the Nagas, I think, yeah, definitely the lowest. So I'm going with 2 for that one.
Okay, and then I'll be the highest one on this guy here.
Oh, okay.
Of us, only because I think we've seen similar precedents to this where like only one like ability plus equipment combo is playable on certain mercs. Like I think like at like Schwen and stuff, right? Where like,
yeah,
that you took like the pounce thing and you did the pounce thing and it was either good enough or it wasn't. And Schwen was basically like not good enough. It was just way too linear. In my opinion, I think that Fathom Lure equipment where it says whenever one of his summoned mercs attacks, you heal Karathres for 12. I think that combo alone with the summon to 816 Naga or whatever, I think that starts to get into a dangerous territory of like going infinite very quickly,
just
that
like
gets
keep
out of hand for
filling
a lot
up your
of
board
decks.
And killing them,
yeah,
and then refilling
like,
it up, and
yeah, you just don't have to have any like think of it as a merc that literally just like summons. It's just a one merc package that just all it needs is Frost, and so it doesn't have to be any other type. It doesn't have to be an
like Frost Kazakus.
Yeah, like, literally, yeah, like with like Sylvanas and
yeah.
Diablo and Kazakus and who knows, and yeah, some other, just like one other like Frost opener or something. I don't know, there's definitely a bunch of funky ways with it, but the fact that I don't know, having summons that have an attack trigger that heals for that much health and you can do it twice and there's no cooldown and summons are very awkward to deal with in a lot of boards, like I actually think that that singular combo of just every single turn you trigger your Frost combo, you summon two 816 Nagas, and then next turn you basically just you heal for 24, you heal for 12, 24, 36, like regularly with this guy. I think it actually does have some niche, like in just a mid-rangey good stuff deck. Again, whether or not that is going to be a viable strategy at all, whether or not you can put this into a Frost deck, I don't know. But I think I am a little bit higher on it just for that combo. And so I'll give it again, like a 3.5 with another like asterisk.
Okay. I dig it. And so that's interesting. I like we've had some different opinions on the Nagas. One thing I do want to add, not about the character, but we've talked about board space before, and I know a lot of us are hoping for more board space. So we talked a little bit about that on the stream, and we got a little bit of behind the scenes insight. So feedback has now been heard about the board. It's going to be passed along. That doesn't mean anything, but it's nice to have been heard. But it sounds like the biggest thing limiting us potentially is the fact that it might be harder to pull it off on mobile. I think it would be fine.
The game already has a lot of weird spacing issues on mobile. Like, you literally can't even read the buffs and debuffs that your characters have on mobile. Like, it's kind
of
crazy.
Yeah, there's a lot of things like that. I personally think it would be great if they could just try and find some way to make it work, but I do understand if that's like the biggest limiter is it just if they can't work on phones and they need, you know, the same thing between the PC and the phone version, which of course you need. So, but it was nice to hear apparently they have done tests and had 25 wisps summoned or something, but you know, that's more about trying to see what can be broken and whatnot and stuff like that. But it is nice to know that feedback's being passed along, because maybe, you know, in the future they could expand it, because we know on PC it can support that. The board space is big enough, just might be a little challenging to make it work on mobile, but maybe in the future we'll see. But I wanted to add that because we've talked about it a bunch on a bunch of different episodes. But moving right along, First Green, Lady Vash, Epic Fighter. This is one I'm more excited for again. This is actually, I believe, in my nature theory craft. And the big thing I like about this one the most is probably their equipment. They have some nice big nature damage potentially too, but the big thing to me is their equipment, where it's another thing of your Naga take 4 less damage until they act each turn. So they figured out a way to make a good payoff for being slow. That is not the nonsense local R is, where if I'm 5 speed and I get the wrong end of the speed tie, I just get absolutely rolled, even though I'm not like a fast character. Like, I think that was really problematic for the game, and I think they've heard that feedback, because all of these slower mechanics, nothing is kind of like local R in terms of punishing fast stuff, or punishing more than just the fastest stuff. Like, it actually cares how fast you are in some of the instances, and I think it's such a better way to do it.
Instead of just killing you.
Yeah, like, it was just too much with local R. It was just a bit too much with local R, whereas here, I think this is a great incentive. We've seen how strong Pearl of Yulon is. This is basically Pearl of Yulon for your Nagas, as long as you're going slower than your opponent. That's insane. Like, that's, and the Nagas want to go slow anyway for their secondary effects a lot of the time, so you're happy. Like, even her own effect, it's dealing more damage by, the damage is reduced by the current speed of whoever you're hitting. So it's like, if they're fast, I'm trucking them for most of this 22 damage, that's 44 crit or something. But if Valera decides to go at 0 speed and we can hit her somehow. So I like this character a lot. Also, she has like a skin where she's like rocking out on a guitar or something. Yeah, right. And I love that. So
there are a couple meme skins.
Oh, there are.
Out here.
And I love it. A+ job on like all the skins, by the way. But I'm giving her like a 3.5, like not the craziest of the Naga, but I think one of the better ones. And I think if you're playing a Naga comp, you're probably playing this in it if you're trying to maximize your Naga synergy.
Yeah, I think for me, I would go probably right around a 3. Yeah, I think she's in between, but yeah, if you're doing Nagas, I think you play her just for that one equipment, the passive alone.
Mm-hmm.
Your Nagas take 4 less damage until they act. I think that's amazing. So, you know, we've seen how strong it is in Dragons, and, you know, her abilities aren't that bad either. She has, as you said, the big hit, basically. Then she also has a smaller hit, but then a bleed, and bleeds also got reworked, so they are a little bit better now, I think.
A little better, a little worse, the trade-off.
Yeah, kind of depends, you know, on who you would
exactly, play. Yeah.
Does bonus nature damage double pump her second ability?
I don't think the bleed is nature.
Honestly,
actually, no, it is. Yeah, no, it should pump the bleed. Yeah, yeah. No, it is nature. Yeah, you're right.
So Brucon +3 would be technically +6 on that ability then for damage and then 3 bleed.
That's cool. That's cool.
Actually, yeah, that is cool.
I didn't think about that. Good, good point.
That's kind of
fell ability too. All our demon lords rejoice. It's actually kind of cool. It's kind of a cool fell ability. This ability
is very good, I think.
Yeah, another slow ability which punishes them. I love they're experimenting a bunch more with dealing critical damage to things that you're not normally critting against, which is so cool. That's awesome design space to be exploring.
Yeah, I think same thing. I would give this Merc like a 3. Her first ability is basically just like deal an 18. I mean, it's a lot-ish. It's like deal 18 or whatever, but like honestly, you start comparing it to in a Chondra, and like that value was available to us in the same color, and it kind of wasn't good enough, and I'm not sure that's really any better. The straight shoot and bleed is nice, and I think, yeah, the AoE is also quite good, but yeah, same thing. I'd give her like a 3.5, but without the asterisk. Like, maybe the asterisk for my other mercs means like if it's actually good, it's like another 0.5 above, and if it's actually bad, then it's like a 0.5 below. But she's like, no matter what, probably going to be always about the same. But the damage prevention thing, yeah, we might be sleeping on that by a lot. I wouldn't be surprised if we were kind of undervaluing that. But again, just another, like, it's a good one. Like, you're 100% playing it in your Naga deck, right? And you just jam. And it's got cool nature stuff. Again, every Naga, yeah, like you said, has kind of been able to split across multiple different archetypes, which has been really sweet. So,
yeah. And the next one here, I believe, our second red of the bunch, and that is Tide Mistress Atissa. This is one I'm pretty high on. I think this is one of the better Nagas. Got some split between Frost and Nature spell schools. And the big thing to me is that first Frost ability, you can just start stacking some Nature weakness, and it's +5 Nature weakness. That's nothing to scoff at. And you don't even need other Nature units. You can get that payoff just from her, because her other two abilities are Nature. And the last one, it's increased by 7 for each other Naga you control, and it starts at 20 for an AoE. That's pretty insane. It is 7 speed and 3 cooldown, so that's going to be like an end the game. But there are ways to cheat that down a little bit, I believe. Like one of her equipments helps refresh it a little bit faster whenever she takes damage. And this is also Naga Mukla, because she can summon a 12-24 Naga with taunt. So no power creep. You know, it's not better than Mukla's big brother. It's just a different tribe. But that's nice for the queen. The queen certainly appreciates that. Another Naga on board, another +1/+6, another way to protect your stuff. Like, I think easy 4 for me. I think next to the queen, probably my favorite Naga. I think this card is really, really good.
Yeah, I think I would actually follow up same with 4 on that. We've seen how good Big Brother can be with Mukla, and especially now that having this in a Naga tribe, a new one that's coming out, I think, you know, that could be a really good one. And then also, as you said, the other equipment where you can refresh that last ability that has 3 cooldown. I mean, if she gets hit 3 times, you get to use it the second turn. Or actually, no, sorry, even get hit twice on turn 1.
Yeah. And then she gets boom, to turn 2, which is nuts. Huge absurd. Yeah, imagine if you have Nagas. Like, yeah, if you have just 2 other Nagas, that's another 14, and you're hitting for 34, 68 critting.
Yeah. So
big numbers.
Yeah, I think she's 4, and, you know, as you just said, big numbers, and we've seen Sinestra big numbers and how that's, you know, worked out. So
true.
I'm gonna go for a solid 4 on her.
What do you think?
I had at this high. I had her at as probably also my second best Naga, I think. Too many. I think what I always keep kind of going back to, like, this, like, the bench Brucon identity for so many of these mercs, where, like, there's a lot of, like, sit on the bench and then come out and immediately threaten, like, a big 6-7 speed AoE, and, like, you, if you just can't one-shot them, like, they always get their value, and then, but in this case, they're also having options with, like, the Riptide, like, just,
yeah,
if you can board it in as, like, an anti-attacking, like, yeah, like, position 4 style, like, just, like, in the middle of the game, suddenly be like, oh, this turn, actually, I know that they have to attack with these two things, I can just go, like,
punish him for it. Yeah.
And so, like, yep. I think there are cool things about that. And on top of the fact that it's basically, yeah, a Mukla, but with real abilities on every single part is crazy. And the same color. Like, the fact that it's also the same color, too, is so good, and in a better tribe, arguably. So, yeah, I think also, like, a 4 and a super duper solid. It's not like this card can't be bad in a weird way. It's just going to be consistent and very good if you open with it, if you play it from the bench.
You don't even need to play it in Nagas. You can play it in Nature, and I think you can have a great time with it. Like, giving that Nature weakness and then using your Nature abilities, like, boom, there you go. Imagine healing on top of that with Malph and some of these other new Nature guys we got. Like, crazy stuff.
Like in MAM in that sense, like yeah. I guess it's like a more offensive Mukula, where Mukula is maybe like better as like a support, like a true support character, where Athissa is actually
yeah.
having the taunt and then a more proactive game plan or just a higher damage game plan. That's been a big deal. Mukula has suffered by not doing enough by himself, and Athissa certainly does enough on her own.
Mm-hmm. Nice. Yeah. No, that's, I think we're all pretty much in agreement on this one. Definitely one of the stronger Nagas of the bunch. And we're down to our last one. So we're zipping right along here. Lord Slitherspear, our last fighter Naga. So let's see. With him, more summoning stuff, which is cool. Also some Divine Shield stuff. So there is potential there with some mercs that I haven't seen play in the past that care about Divine Shield, like Nu Zhao and stuff. I think the big thing with him, though, is he is kind of a summon hater in a lot of ways. But summons usually haven't been at a point where they've been problematic in most of the mercenaries meta. They can be all right sometimes or even good, but they haven't been the primarily dominant strategy in mercenaries. And I guess this is another Naga where they're more physically based, where they don't really have the spell schools. It's just more attacking and whatnot. So unless we see a very radical change in how summons work, which is possible because we got a fair amount of summon units, I think this is kind of on the lower end of the Nagas. I'd probably give it more of like a 2-ish. Like, I don't think it's terrible. I just don't think it slots in as many builds as some of the other ones, and it's a little bit, it just doesn't have as much synergy mm-hmm. with some other characters. So I'd probably give it more in the lower range, like 2-ish.
Yeah, I'm going to say 2.5 for this one, just because we are seeing a lot more summons, especially if this mm-hmm. drop in even yeah. recently with N'Zoth and stuff. So, you know, if there are a ton of summons coming out, you know, he's decent counter to them. So I think, you know, even just running him as like a solo in a deck, if there's just a summon meta, mm-hmm. I mean, I think he's going to be kind of strong with that, especially, you know, summon mini doesn't trigger a death rattle because there are some of them that, you know, give buffs or other things. True. So I think it could be pretty good.
Yeah,
like he also looks like another one where the numbers are wrong. It looks like the 877 is copied.
Oh yeah, it's like 880 max. Yeah, 880. Interesting. Oh, okay. So he has a little bit more stats.
Those, yeah, a little tiny bit. Yeah, I also have him as probably the low, especially since I came up a little bit more on the Zarjira, mm-hmm. which Sea Queen won from before. That, yeah, I think I have Slitherspear as the weakest of the Naga, or essentially like the Naga that if you're gonna start cutting Naga from your Naga deck, I think you start with Slitherspear. I think you start to find better replacements. He has, again, this like Xuan effect where he has like a 5-speed attack for a big amount, but that's just honestly just not good enough, and Xuan even did it faster. And mm-hmm. so the summon is fine. And you can summon, yeah, like summoning like a 15-18 is nice, and it's
with Divine
like,
it Shield, rush.
It,
so it'll live.
Yeah, like it's kind of like the N'Zoth 15-15 that doesn't take damage. It's very
10-18 though. It's not 15.
Or sorry, with the equipment, because I think
with the equipment, yes, equipment. Yep, yeah. I got you.
But I'm not even sure if you're like using that ability very often, because I think you're just going gain 10 attack, punch something.
Yeah, just
another
buff
10
them
attack,
up, punch,
just, like, 30
buff
attack,
up, punch,
whatever. But
yeah.
Again, at that point, yeah, are you just playing, should you just be playing a Samuro or something? I don't know. So it's a little bit more of a filler Naga, like a support Naga in that kind of sense for me in this deck. And I see the anti-summon mechanic just as it's actually just sick to have. It's like having a sideboard card in your main deck for no reason. And like mm-hmm. you never cast it, but like sometimes you just get them.
Yeah.
And this is one of those things where I think you just never cast it in like 80% of your games, even if you're playing Slitherspear at all. But sometimes it's actually honestly not bad, and the fact that that is just a free roll compared to it just being an ability that you might mm-hmm. never cast. Like, how many characters just have a third ability that's just literally you never click it? Yeah, in this case, you just happen to like counter a certain kind of deck, and that just will strictly only feel good and will probably never feel bad. And so that, I think, buffs them up a little bit. I'll give them a 2.5, but I think it's the first Naga you start to cut.
Yeah,
your Naga deck.
I agree. I think definitely cool character, but the synergies aren't really necessarily there to where you might just want more synergistic spell school stuff rather than just having a body in there to be a Naga. So I think we're all in agreement about that one. The next one is probably my favorite character of the bunch, and I am like beyond thrilled that they got such cool abilities. Captain Hook Tusk, our blue pirate, first blue pirate. We get two blue pirates this set. She's not only a blue, though, and that is where things get... We've talked about this so much in the past. Also, we did get a little confirmation, I believe, from Charles on Twitter. So she has an ability where her first attack, you gain health, you swap roles with an enemy, and you attack it. So I'm attacking Trigor. Trigor is becoming blue. I'm becoming red. So on and so forth. That's fucking awesome. That is so cool that you can just be like, all right, not only am I changing what my opponent is, I'm changing what I am. That changes so much of the game. Also, think about this. You swap with something and then you swap again with something else. It totally throws like the typical color balancing for teams out of whack, and I love it. Also confirmed, you can swap with a neutral. Not summons, though. Oh. Summons do not have a type, but we do have Lorewalker Cho down here a bit. He can become a neutral. If you swap roles with Cho, she does become a neutral. So neutral mercs possible, which is really cool. On top of that, she just has an interesting second ability, too, where it's just like you get more damage if it's a certain type, and then it rotates through that type. So it like cares about you hitting certain types, so you're like incentivized to. And one of her equipments is literally battle cry. You get three attack and you become a fighter. That's so fucking cool. You can literally bluff your opponent that you have two blues or whatever, and then she pops in as a green, and then you swap the green. There's so much potential. I think by far my favorite character. And I think the power level's there for it too. Apparently she used to be a little bit faster, pre-release from what I heard, and originally the first skill was actually going to speed up your other pirates, but I think because of Edwin they had to give her a little bit base lower stuff, because you have to remember her speed looks a little slow, and then you remember Edwin boosts pirates by four, and then her abilities look way better. I think it's very playable. And I think it's the most interesting and fun card of the bunch, or at least tied. So this is one I'm just slamming that hard five on. I love everything about this card. I'm grinding it up day one, and I'm going to jam some fucking pirates.
That's cool that you found. So that we found maybe our first choose your Pokemon answer of the bunch so far that's actually elicited this response from us. Hook Tusk, a Pokemon that is worth investing in as a starter from Zombies Check.
Oh, yeah.
The Zombies
Stand. I love it.
Okay, I like it. Our first one.
Yeah, I think she could be very strong, especially like the cool thing about the first build is where you swap roles with the enemy and then attack it. So instead of like blues always hitting reds, you would want to hit into greens now, which you don't, because then you become blue. Yeah, so it's like you're hitting the opposite role. So
that's
actually
so cool.
Really cool design on it.
And if you take that equipment that makes you a fighter, you start to use it to target protectors.
That's so cool.
So like if the meta has a lot of protectors in your openers, you could swap your equipment and keep your same deck, and it like targets a completely different like style of deck that you're seeing. Yeah, that's very, very sweet. Good point.
Yeah, I think she's definitely very flavorful. Like just looking at the patch notes, like all of the text and everything, and you know, as we've seen, as we're gonna go up, there's a lot of mercenaries that have like a whole page of text now on some of them. So I'm glad to see it. But yeah, I'm gonna give her a solid 4 on this one. Especially like being in Pirates with like an Edwin, you know, even though she is like slow, like I think what is slowest one's speed 8, but then, you know, that becomes speed 4.
Four.
So that's
4 is not that bad. Yeah.
Yeah. Super 4 fun. 4 I think is going to be really good. So especially seeing like a lot of slower things like Nagas and stuff.
You can change your friendlies too. I want to mention that you can change your third ability, change a Merc's role to caster. Obviously you'd be bleeding it, but you can change your own stuff. Like I thought this was going to be character we'll talk about soon. Maestra's stuff was going to be swapping it about and changing, but no, it's Hook Tusk, and I'm absolutely here for it. It's so fucking cool.
Yeah. No, I think it's definitely a really cool, like, it's pirates definitely needed like fun mercs to be able to play with. Like none of the like
Eudora and just was, blues. Like, interesting you just needed blues.
But, yeah, and just there were no blues. Or yeah, we got Rogers, Skyma Rogers instead, which was kind of like the
she's the pirate hater.
Supposed to be the pirate blue, but yeah, she's anti-pirate instead. So no, I think Hookjax is really sweet. I think I don't have any of my pirates ready, right? In that sense, it's like from the start, from the pick your Pokemon starter, I'm not going to pick Hooktusk. But I think that Hooktusk is very good and fun. I'll give that an easy four, at least, I would say.
Yeah, super fun character. Probably tied. Favorite of the bunch. I just love it. But she's not the only caster we got. We got, and this just brought such a smile to my face seeing this character come up again. Patches the Pirate. He's back in charge. And also just huge shout out to like the development team who made these characters, because damn if they didn't make like some, they chose some really iconic characters that if you asked me how do I make this character feel like Patches and Mercenaries, I'd be like, I have no idea. Like it's so hard to imitate that effect of blasting them out of the deck. They found a way to do that. Like there's a passive after a friendly pirate merc dies, summon this merc, gain 3 attack and attack a random enemy. So he just pops out of your bench and you better believe that that cannon animation better be there. He's just boom. I absolutely love it. He cares about summons, which pirates other than Eudora haven't typically cared about, but I'm happy Edwin got changed. So you don't have to care about adjacent stuff anymore. So you're not really worried about positioning there, but I think Hooktusk is probably a little bit stronger of a unit potentially, but I think Patches is still really strong. His stats are beefy as hell. 13 attack. That's a ton of attack and 81 HP. That's like a lot. He summons these little pirates, which are just kind of getting in for the damage for the most part. You have some ways to kind of make them immune like Nazoth, but I don't think that's really worth doing. You don't really want to fill up your board full of pirates. Necessarily, but at the same time, you do also have something where his other equipment, whenever a friendly pirate attacks, you get give it +5 attack. You can make some big freaking other pirates with this, and he's already a big pirate on his own. Like imagine Sneeds with this, who already gets gigantic. It's you can fill up your board with pirates. I just love everything about this. I think he's a little bit less strong and flexible than Hooktusk, but I think that's okay because Hooktusk is an insane card. And he's a little bit faster, like his speeds, especially with Edwin, definitely get a bit faster. So I like him. I'm going to give him like that 3.5, like solidly playable pirate. You will want to be playing him in pirate builds most likely. And yeah,
as an opener,
I think there are builds that can work out with both. Like if I quickly look at the pirate build I brewed, I had him on the bench as we are using, I wasn't even using the pop-in one, but there is a cool interaction, and we got this confirmed on Twitter, where it's possible to actually, with Patch's ability, there is a way to actually get 4 mercenaries in play at once, which is really, really cool, and potentially busted. So yeah, I give him like 3.5-ish, like solid card.
Yeah, I'm going to go the same with 3.5. Main thing is from that interaction of raising it up a little bit because of that. Mm-hmm. Because having 4 mercs on the board,
pretty crazy.
Know, that's even more than just casting another ability like from a mercenary. It's your opponent's like, okay, what am I going to do now? There's 4 targets. Because a lot of time there's like, okay, yeah, there's a support and there's like 2 I kind of want to pick between. Now there might be 4 and they got to like decide like, okay, wait, am I going to go for this one or that one? It's just like, it's so much more potential of damage and stuff too. But I think that definitely raises it up. And also the one thing to mention about that is if you do have 4 mercenaries on the board, when the 4th one dies, you do not get to pull another mercenary off the bench. You'll stay at 3. And then once the 3rd one dies, then you get to put on your last one.
Important to note. Yeah.
Yeah. I'll give him a solid 3.5 for that one.
Yeah, I think by himself, he's only okay at best. Like, in reality, the fact that he, like, comes in from the... I do think the come-from-your-bench equipment is the best part. And the combo that we're talking about is with Maestro, who we'll get to in a little bit. But I think, realistically, by himself, if you hadn't read Maestro, then I think he's, like, a solid 3. Like, at most ish. Like, I think they're, his abilities are like fine. The summon, they like a 10/5 pirate with rush is basically just, you can almost maybe think of it like scabs with just the kind of like attack something,
little
and then
bonus
combo
damage.
Attack
yeah.
for 10. It's basically that with some better upside a lot of the time. But the fact that it can be combined with Maestra, I think I would not be surprised if every single pirate deck was playing Patches and Maestra and it became maybe very annoying soon.
Interesting. So
I think that if you ever see a Patches, it's almost certainly going to be with a Maestra and it will be the de facto pirate deck. That will be my call. Because of that, I think it might even be like, please nerf it soon. So I'll put it
like original Patches.
Yeah, literally, like I think this interaction might be a little too crazy. We'll see. But yeah, so I'll give it with the Maestro combo like a 4 to 4.5 with an asterisk. But if that isn't as broken as we think, yeah, it's like a 2 to 3. You might not even really play it in your pirate deck at all.
I think it's reasonable in pirates, but it's not like insane, but because of our other blue swapping around so much, you can kind of get away with two blues on your bench, right? Or two blues with the Maestra and Patches. Cause it's like, well, Hook Tusk isn't always even a blue. So you can kind of get away with that, or more comps. Most comps usually can't really do that as easily. So pretty high on Patches. If I was rating his art, it'd be easy fives. Cause he has some really, really cool portraits. But next up, Reno Jackson
League.
So yeah, our first explorer, we have three of the four League of Explorers dropping in this one. Finley is away excavating the Sunken City. Maybe we'll see him show up in an event or something like that in the near future. Who knows? Maybe a red Murloc. We'll see. But Reno also S tier skins. But he's a human, so useful for human comps. He also arcane support. I do really like that. And he just has really cool and interesting abilities. I love that they have reasons to play the explorers together where you can benefit from each other and how they're kind of different, like where Reno's benefits coming off the bench and he gets his big heal effect like he does in Constructed, but you don't have to use him that way. That's just an option. And I think they just really did a good job, like with the vast majority of these characters, giving them interesting options for your equipment. Reno's no exception there. I think he's just a very solid character. The big thing, I think, he has like spell taunt, kind of. He can hit something, he can gain taunt, so he's blocking stuff regularly. And then whatever he hits, their next ability targets this merc if possible. That's huge. We've never had like spell taunt like that before. So
it's better than spell taunt, right? Like, it's full. It's everything taunt.
It's just like super taunt. Like, yeah.
It's blessing of sacrifice. It's spell skite for the OGs.
Yeah.
The magic gamers. In the chat. Yeah. No, I think I have Reno as part of my also like quick list, like top five. I think he's sneakily way better than he might appear.
Like looks on paper.
Yeah, I think that second, if there's actually no cooldown on the Dazzle and Flexin thing, where, yeah, it's deal 7 to something, gain taunt, and
it's no cooldown on base. If you run the item, you can get cooldown, but more like damage. But it hits everything, so you could literally full. But yeah, I see what you're saying.
And that part is sweet. And like, if you start to play him as like a benchy kind of merc, then I think he does start to get better with that type of equipment. But I just like his Death Rattle. I think the Death Rattle
Death Rattle is cool.
Yeah, you just I think you can just lead with him and you start to just like be this disruptive like control card, and if he dies he has a great Death Rattle. It's like, right, you're redirecting to him. He's like a blue Tyrion in a weird way that
actually has taunt.
Really seen yet. That can, like, literally, like, yeah, even if you don't want to do anything with it, like, you can just taunt. Like, you can just have a taunt in this deck that's very legit, even if you don't care about what actual ability you're stealing. And that's the best part of that ability, and it deals damage, and it's a two speed,
and it's arcane.
It sets up another thing, and it's arcane, and it benefits from spell damage really like decently.
Yeah,
and that's my treasure, like Lightning Helix, where it's just like randomly deals 15 to 25, and then, or it randomly heals 15 to 25 apparently randomly.
So it could be a bunch of a different there's a list of them. I'll run through them really quick. That I believe these are them all. So he gets two of them randomly out of this bunch.
But his third ability says restore 15 to 25 health.
Oh, I didn't even.
Yeah.
Huh.
Maybe that's saying like the lowest level. I literally assumed it was random. I thought it was roll a die.
Yeah, it's got to be random. Five.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I think it's random. So at the worst, you're doing healing 15 and dealing 15. But then, best heal damage equal to the amount. Yeah. So then,
that's why it's random.
Less.
Yeah.
You could deal less if you. Well, it's also if you only because it's the amount actually healed.
Yeah.
So
oh.
If you heal a bunch, only have 5 health less, it'll only deal. 5,
yeah. Yeah. But, okay. Yeah.
But again, if you're ever, I mean, it has one cooldown, so you're just like opening, going dazzling, flex, and steal one of your abilities, take any amount of damage, probably even do it again the next turn, and then just.
And you have a payoff when he dies.
Shooting you for 20, just shooting you for 20 and healing for 20 is now like, now your Reno just continues to stay around and continues to suck away all these abilities. Mm-hmm. And then even when I finally do kill it, it just nukes my board or something crazy. So I actually think he's pretty good. And especially if the League of Explorers, if that package is playable, it's definitely Reno only gets better, obviously. But I think we'll be, I have him as actually the best of the explorers personally.
Really?
So I would put him at like a 4 with an asterisk where it's up or down in various ways. I think he's better than people think.
I agree. I'm same right there. 4. I think he's good and he's like deceptively strong just looking at the abilities versus like seeing them in game.
Yeah, I went 4.5 just because of that death rattle. Having 2 random treasures, like already all of the treasures is good. If you got just a 1, I think would be fine. But now getting 2 of them, and basically they're almost always going to be useful. I think that right there bumped him up a little bit higher for me. So yeah, I'm doing 4.5 on him.
Yeah, so we all think he's good. Here are the treasures, if you don't know, super quick. They're not all the in-game treasures. It's a small pool, which is good for balance reasons. Deal 25 to a random enemy. Deal 12 to all enemies. 10 damage to an enemy and root it. Deal 15 damage to a character and freeze it. That must be an enemy. There's no way that's friendly. Deal 11 damage to an enemy and heal 25 to your characters. And those are all of them. And I believe if it doesn't specify, it's random targets. So hopefully it's not freezing your own character. That would be a little bit of a downside. Yeah. But all the other ones are good. So even if that happens,
Random root and random freeze, I think, are the worst ones. In that sense, that like often they will deal the least amount of damage and then not have a
at least root says enemy. At least the character scares me a little bit on the freeze, but yeah. I don't think it'd be that trolly. But yeah, Reno looking fucking awesome. Like he looks really good.
Pretty good. Cool.
And it should be 2 because it does say 2 random ones. Do you think the same one could be rolled twice or no? Do you think it'll be like it gets this one and then one of the other?
I'd say it's possible. I mean, it might not, but I think it's definitely a possibility if it's just pulling from a pool. I think it could go either way though. We'll have to see when he comes out. But yeah, so Reno, our first explorer, and what's nice is each of the explorers is a different role, which is really cool for running them together. So Bran, our red explorer here, he's also a dwarf. So we had some cards that cared about dwarfs before. Bran is super freaking cool because he has a bunch of his abilities have frost resist, but depending on what item you have, you change that to a different resist. So he can do fire resist, he can do frost resist, and he can do shadow resist. So that right there, he's covering a ton of bases. And we're also, his abilities are granting it to your characters. Like, we've seen how powerful that can be with things like in the early days with Gruul. We really haven't had that blanket resist much since then. And this is against fire, not so much, but shadow and frost have been two of the best, like, things in the game for like a while in terms of tribes. So I think there's insane potential here. Like also on top of that, the shadow resist one makes Bran just naturally 3 speed faster, which is nuts. Valera. Like he's already fast. So he's like Valera Bran. Yeah, crazy. And he has that ability where he can, if you heal something and then if it's already acted, you repeat their ability. So it's like Bran's double battle cry thing. Insane. Mm-hmm. Like I think I would rate this even higher than Reno. I would probably put this at like 4.5. I think this has insane potential, not only in explorers builds, but just as like general utility against different things in the meta. If you're seeing a lot of frost or a lot of shadow.
Yeah, I'm going to go same 4.5, mainly for that third ability, how you can repeat their ability. So we've seen that there's some mercs that can just have ability that just devastates. So, and if they live and then get to do because it's speed 8, so you can do it again on them. Like, that could be board wiping sometimes. So I think that's really good. And then, yeah, also just, you know, he's like a support protective merc, so you just can get tons of resistance and seeing, especially, not currently because of Trigor meta, but before, it's always been normally spells that are, like, spell schools dominating. There was, like, Shadow for a while in the beginning, and then a lot of Frost, even though it was a little bit of Fire here and there. So I think, you know, having that just kind of, like, keep your team all alive, and as you said, like, a blanket resist, I think that can be very strong. So, yeah, I'm also going 4.5 for him.
Cool.
Okay. I think this is the closest to a 1 that I've seen.
Really?
Of the mercs that we have. I'll take the full polar opposite for the betting memes thing. I think of the League of Explorers themselves, I think he's the worst one.
Mm-hmm.
And I think when realistically everybody's playing ladder, you have to have, maybe I'm just like getting triggered by the fact that it's like a little, it lends itself a little bit too hard to like counter queuing.
Kind of yeah.
But the problem is I don't even think he's good enough as a counter queue style card to have like, to be teching in somewhere randomly. Like, I think you just start to be like, oh, well, now if I'm playing Bran, then should I just be playing the League of Explorers? Because if I'm not, Bran by himself isn't very strong. The double ability is cool, but I think it's probably greedy / like win Mori. But again, the fact that you will often, they just won't target Bran because he kind of doesn't do anything, has this weird like perception thing where like you can see it as this ticking time bomb, but if you're opening him with the League of Explorers, that seems like the best way to do it because Elise has a good equipment that way. But if you're putting him on the bench, why? I don't really think it's that meaningful. I think it's just you're really hard-pressed to play a character, especially we're reading all these different mercs that have like crazy abilities, through multiple different abilities that are all very good and in like bigger tribes or like real big payoff tribes. And I don't even really see the explorers having a good enough payoff internally because like they give a lot of stats to themselves, but they don't ever actually utilize the attack stat. So it's only for like retaliation damage. The health is okay, but now it's just like a heal. And now it's a worse version of a heal from some other things. So I actually am pretty low on the explorers. I'll put them at, yeah, like a 1 to a 2.
Wow.
For the meme, I'll call them a 1.
Okay. Well, our next one is pretty much our only explorer that can actually attack under certain conditions, and that is Elise, our green explorer. And so this is kind of the interesting thing, is if you're not running her in a nature build, you actually benefit from the stats greatly because she is attacking. She's only like doing it ranged if you're nature comboing. So I think like a big plan with the explorers can be your Reno is your Reno and your Bran are kind of your protection. And then you just make a really big Elise. Like, I think that's a possibility. And then the other reason for that is a big Elise is kind of nice if you can protect it, because Elise has one of the coolest, if not the coolest, abilities in the game, which is, and I literally brought this up when they previewed her. I was like, there's no way they can involve the golden monkey. Like, there's just no way. Like, it's just too convoluted to convert that from an old Hearthstone mechanic into a mercenary. They did it. It's freaking sweet. So Elise has, we've never seen a character like this. She starts with her third ability, and when you use it, it transforms into the next one, and there are 5 stages, and that last stage is the golden monkey. 5 speed summons a 20/20 golden monkey. It has passive. Your characters have +15 spell damage. That's absurd. That's like, I used Vol'jin as the example. If you have this, you have 3 mercs on the board and the monkey. That is 60 spell damage. So just casual Vol'jin 80, 1 speed, just 1 speed, 80 their board really quick if you get the golden monkey. Is it like going to happen every game? No way. But I think there are ways that this could happen. Will it be good enough to be like a meta player? Who knows? But for me, at least, between design and also, I think Elise has a ton of potential in nature comps too. Elise, I think I'm just slapping the big 5 on. Like, I think she's one of, if not the, like, she's tied basically with Hooktusk for me for, I think, the coolest and one of the most powerful mercs in the set.
Interesting.
Yeah, I'm a little back and forth on her. I think design wise, I think she is one of my favorite mercs. Like, having a whole quest line tied to her,
yeah,
I think is amazing. And then, you know, having this now means, hey, are we going to get another merc later on? Maybe that has another type of quest thing or something like this. So it's really cool to have that all opened up.
Her buffing's insane, though. Like, it's almost better Tyrion, and it buffs herself, and also nature. That's a nature ability too. Steps one and steps three of the quest are nature, and and once you complete the quest, it actually loops back around. So you start back at stage one, and you can go through it again. So you don't permanently lose those abilities. And if you like speed it up somehow, like with Tyrande, it'll remember that step got sped up when you loop back around. Probably not going to happen very much in PvP, but still pretty cool.
Do we know if the equipment that says advance the quest, like start of game, advance the quest two steps, does it actually cast those two spells?
No, you just start. You start on
the buff
because it's start of the game. So it happens before any mercs are in play. I did ask about that one. So she does start right away on root all enemy characters, which if it's a very attacking heavy meta, that's kind of great. If your opponent's going to be attacking much, you just be like, and it's also anti-Trigor, right? Because you root them, but you're not damaging them. So you're not taking any residual from rooting. So, but the big downside, minus 20 health, and that's at max rank. I heard that at level one, it's minus 35 health.
It gets like less painful.
It gets worse, or it gets better. But so I think that equipment is probably a meme and bad because minus 20 health is a lot. But maybe if there is a build that's trying to rush the monkey, maybe. Because that's insane. Like the monkey's insane.
I'm gonna say three. I think I'm gonna give her three. I think she gets stronger, of course, if you do have room in the League of Explorers and have the +4/+4. To Braun and Reno at the end of turn. If it was also giving her +4/+4, I think then that would be very strong, but it's just them two, which, you know, it's still eight stats at the end of turn, which isn't bad, but both of them can't attack, so it's kind of just the health. I mean, Reno can taunt, so there is retaliation, but I think, I'm going to go three on her, because I think, at least in PvP-wise, I don't think the quest is going to be as possible. That we will see some games people finish it, but I don't think it's going to be like every game, like, hey, I'm always
not at all
this condition and this is how definitely I win
not.
And stuff.
Yeah.
Kind of so yeah, I think I'm going to go for fringe. Three for her.
Okay.
I think she's, I'm honestly not even necessarily sure if she's better than Bran in that sense. I'm going to give her like probably like a 2.5. I think it's cool the League of Explorers gets to be like the Highlander kind of meme deck that like you play against it. Like it's one of those decks that you're glad is in the meta because you play against it. It's like what Demons used to be in kind of way. And you just like, you just know that you're going to win, but it's going to be like kind of fun. Like literally in card games, it's like some of the best matchups are when you load into the game and you go, oh, I am a humongous favorite in this matchup. And then you get to play it out and you still have to play it out. But knowing that you're a favorite, I honestly think that's going to be like the League of Explorers meme, is that you're going to be a dog in every matchup. And so I don't think I'm not that high on it, but I recognize and realize that it's almost like the meme version of the old gods. Like they're making the old gods playable.
Yeah.
And the League of Explorers like the meme deck instead of kind of like the other way around of being like the good guys are sick. It's like, no, the good guys are a meme. And then like the bad guys are sick. And so I like it, but I still, realistically, I'll put it like a 2.5. I don't think that deck is going to be real in PvP.
Yeah, I think the biggest thing and why I'm so high on it is literally just that embark on the quest. Buffing herself and everything else, +5/+8, turn one, speed three, just absurd.
The only thing
is... Do you ever get to do it on turn one, though?
Yeah, well, I mean, why don't you? I mean, it's three speed. You can do it before a lot of other characters can act, right? Like, even your own. Doesn't have a cooldown.
Doesn't it start on... Do you not have to do Guiding Path? Like, Guiding Path just, no matter what, progresses it, but the... So, Embark on the Quest is the first one with no cooldown.
Yes.
5/8.
I believe you can just do that on turn
that's
one.
That's definitely strong.
Yeah, I guess if you could do that and, like, taunt on Reno...
Like you're buffing up the Reno and you can kind of protect it. Also, you can make a really, really big Elise with the other explorers. And then she buffs the Bran and Reno at the end of turn. It's interesting. Like, will it be good enough? I'm not sure until like I play with it. But purely off the back of that, giving your bench and your in-play units counting yourself, we've seen how good Tyrion is. I think this is better than Tyrion Death Rattle.
No, I think that's honestly, for some reason, I was thinking that you had to cast the heal. Like, I thought that you almost had to, like, start with a guiding path thing. If you can just come out and she just
I don't think so, yeah.
Blue 18 is also, like, a completely ludicrous number for
a yeah. If they don't have heals, like, your dude is dead in a few turns.
Okay, just kidding. Never mind. I'll revise mine to say that she's a lot better than I thought. I thought there was, like, a really disjointed first step that was...
Like, you had to start it with skill 2 and then go and... Yeah.
I don't know what I was thinking necessarily. But, okay, just kidding. Yeah, I think she is probably actually a weirdly better Tyrion.
Yeah. So then, she's good. I think she's good.
Then, all right, yeah. All right, I'll give her a 3.5 with, like, an asterisk then. She's maybe... The bleed 18 is also, yeah, like, really insane. Yeah.
That basically Root just means whatever, but mercenaries will die eventually in like a turn or two or something.
2 turns, yeah.
Yeah, so that's pretty cool. Yeah, all right, okay. Cool stuff.
Because I like Reno and I like her a little bit more. I don't. Bran is still a sticking point for me, I think, but 2 out of 3 isn't bad.
Yeah, and I still think you're criminally underrating Bran, but we'll see. So next up, and we're getting near the end here, the last few. Our Maestra. So we talked about her before. Maestra is also really freaking cool. So she has a combo ability that gains role advantage. So you're not actually swapping the roles, but it's basically like you're treating it like you have the better role. And that's awesome. Another really cool mechanic that I'm happy to see. But the bigger thing, I think, are the equipment. So this is the first time, I guess, next to patches where it's like we have a way of like this is like Long Jin mind games level to like a next level. Like her first one, after a friendly merc dies, summon this merc who uses dirty tricks 5 immediately. All right. So that's kind of like a swap in, but with an attack. That's OK. But the bigger one, after a friendly merc attacks, swap it with this merc who then uses the shifting strike immediately. So you can literally bluff your open. Essentially, like you can say, I'm attacking with this psych, it's actually Maestra, and I think that's so freaking cool. Like, you just put little switcheroo on him real fast. And then you can. So, what is the combo here? We were talking, there's a way to do
it's after a friendly merc dies. Because then patches one.
Oh,
dies,
okay, and it triggers. The they both come out. Gotcha.
So you have the two
friendly pirates dying triggers both.
Yeah.
Yeah. So basically, if you do that, then she comes out, and then patches will attack, and then she also does her dirty tricks, which is the first one deals.
So they both come in, and they both attack. That's pretty sick.
Yeah. And the good
and
thing
dirty
is
tricks is even. Oh no, it's shifting. No, yeah, dirty tricks, and like so that one's even better for having a disjointed number. Like if you have four dudes and they have 3. She hits 2 because she'll cleave. And so
The board space matters a lot. Really like Eudora's cannons.
Actually kind of affect that then. I wonder if positioning in your deck will matter when you make the deck. Because if
like how it comes
first,
out in order?
Yeah. Because if like say she's higher up in your deck list, will
she
come
comes out
then
yeah.
more patches? Because you need that because you want her more in the center. Where is
true.
If she's on the edge, then that won't actually be that good. She'll definitely only hit 1 at most.
That's a good point. I didn't even think about that. Positioning matters.
In your deck now.
Yeah, positioning in your deck. Starts. That's really funny. That's a really funny one. I think this is so freaking cool. Like, the combo gain roll advantage and a way to cheat it out of the deck when something dies or even before something dies on, like, a thing like that. And then the combo with patches. Also, she's an orc. So we finally have a decent blue orc that's like a real caster other than Gul'dan. So easy, like probably an easy 4 for me purely off of just like character looks good and the patches combo seems sweet.
Yeah, I'm going on 4 too. Yeah, that patches combo can be really good. But even without that, I think her other ability is pretty good. Like even her third ability, even though it's 8 speed, give an enemy plus 15 attack this turn. So it's most likely after they attacked if they're attacking character. Then force it to deal the attack damage to neighbors. That's gonna hit hard. I mean, like there, that's 15 to your left, right, and then the center takes retaliation, and that's not including whatever damage they have on them. Also,
you can just do it to a summon too, that you can just kill off afterwards.
Yeah,
so you have to worry about it getting big and sticking around.
Well, the plus 15 is only that turn.
Oh, so this turn. I'll be honest. I totally missed that part of the text.
Yeah, so that was a bonus.
So you don't even have to worry about that.
Yeah, so it's literally just, hey, I'm going to buff it up. It's going to smack both of your guys, and then it just goes back to normal. So, and I actually think it is good going slow, like I said, just so you don't buff it up this turn. It swings, hits back really hard if it's still alive or something, you know?
Yeah.
So going at speed 8, I don't really think there's like any attackers at even 8 speed. Is there anyone who attacks that's that slow?
Yeah, Grom has an 8, but he never uses it.
Oh, yeah.
He uses the other two skills. They exist. They're not good, though.
Yeah, so basically this will always be, like, useful. Don't have to worry
about it. It's like the Sylvanas ability, but a little bit better, right? It's like the Sylvanas that makes things, like, trade into stuff, and I always forget that happens. So I think this is one of those, like, people are not going to be thinking about this ability as much, I think, and it's going to catch people off guard because, like, her other abilities are very strong.
Yeah, for sure.
What do you think for this one, Malhu?
Oh, yeah. No, I was just reading. Like, yeah, there's so many interesting...
I know.
I was thinking Eudora, and, like, the fact that you can have, like, start Eudora, spawn a cannon.
Dip her out, get another cannon. Oh, that's sick. That's really cool.
And then back in your deck, and then you can tutor her back out again. Like,
and Eudora's the fast pirate, too. Like, that's very cool.
Speed because of
Edwin. Yeah.
So you'd have to have a way to trigger the combo still, so you could get the combo from her, from Maesher, probably. There's also some cool portraits, too. No, I think Maesher's sick. Again, I think purely the Maesher plus patches deck. Like, I imagine a world where it's very frequently just going, like, Sneed, Eudora, Edwin as your opener, and then you have patches and... Or, I mean, you could put a Hook Tusk instead of Sneed if you want. You could put a Hook Tusk instead of Eudora. Like, but, like, those six, right? Literally, of just, like, Hook Tusk, Sneed, Eudora, Edwin, patches, Maestra. And you have patches, Maestra on the bench, whoever you want for your fourth, for your last one. And you just kind of, like, almost guarantee that by turn three, ideally, like, on turn three or two, you just have a board of 4 to 5, like, actually 4 mercs, and then maybe cannons, etc. But, like, that merc advantage for that little turn, I think, will be a big, big deal. I wouldn't be surprised if most pirate decks end up doing that, but we'll see. But I think she's really cool. I would give her, like, another, like, 4 with an asterisk of maybe being even higher with this patches thing.
Yeah, so we're all pretty high on her. And like you said, 6 skins. I'm honestly shocked they even put that one with like the Garrosh head in there. It's insane. Yeah, right. I love it. It's so cool. So cool. And I don't think any of us had that on our checklist of characters you'd think you'd see in Mercenaries. Like, never would have expected that. I know both Malhu and myself love some Thief Rogue, so really cool addition there. We're in the home stretch, though. Final 4. Bane Bloodhoof. So Karen's son, I got this wrong before. I thought it was his brother. Karen's son. This one's really, really cool. He's like Karen in a lot of ways where he's very nature focused, but I think he's a little bit more protecting. In like one sense, he's a little bit more protector focused, which I kind of like, whereas Karen, I think you were using him more for his speed than his actual protecting abilities, but also he deals a lot. He has a huge, like, you thought Karen's big stomp was big. He has the giant stomp, the deal 25 to all death blow, set cooldowns on all enemy abilities to their original value. God help your opponent if they have summons. Like, you kill one of their summons and you just lock out all your other, like, cooldown abilities for mercenaries. That seems insane to me. And on top of that, his passive ability, one of them, plus 7 health, plus 4 healing power. We've seen
the equipment,
and this is in a nature build, so you can run this alongside Malph. And we've seen crazy things with Malph and Chi-Gi that required a turn of setup. There's no setup here. You start with plus 4 healing power. That's huge. And he already has ways to heal, so he benefits from it directly. He can gain more healing power. He has nature combo stuff. I think this merc is nuts. I think between some of the other stuff we've seen and this character, there's going to be a very legitimate nature build, and we might even see Chi-Gi come back with it because of that. Because, like, if you can just get to that critical mass where you have a bit of healing power, if your opponent doesn't have the burst damage, like, they just don't ever get through your big bird. Like, it just, we saw it happen in the past, but the meta, I think, was a little bit too bursty, and Chi-Gi required a bit too much setup, but now I think it's a little bit more possible. So I'm giving him a pretty high one. I'm giving him like a solid 4.
Yeah, no, I'm gonna go solid four also. I think he has the strongest healing ability in the game.
Yeah.
With that basically bounce heal, it's like Bruton, but just opposite. It's the huge heal.
Restore 20
to a friendly character. Repeat this on two damage adjacent characters. And if you really want to, you can take the equipment where it makes it so it happens three more times, but has
crazy
plus one cooldown. So yeah, that's six times. That's 120 healing if you do have that one equipment. So anyone who's at low life, just basically a full heal. So, and I'm guessing based off of how they've worked on Bruton recently, with like the whole bug fix, how it like skips, I wonder if that the heal would also kind of skip, like say like the middle one ends up getting like full life or something.
Yeah. No, it's
because
and
of how they did that. So
the totem's cool too. Totem's weird but cool. Like someone brought up a fun.
We were talking about Bane being a totem guy.
So yeah, and he likes the totems. Imagine with that merc that lets you freeze your own stuff and become immune. What if you freeze your own totem and you make it immune? Does it still take the damage instead? Or does it not allow that because it's immune? Because if it still takes the damage, that's like
immune,
a mean...
can be hit.
Yeah.
So I think so.
So maybe
can be hit.
There's a weird combo.
Sacrifice from Cornelius.
Strong. Because it just bounced back and forth.
Oh god, yeah.
Instant
so,
win.
Well, we know what we're gonna have to be testing out early days, but yeah, just insane mercenary. And I mean, giving Karen a run for his money, right?
Like, yeah. Damn. No, I had this. Bane was the last of my rounding out for my like quick top five of. I think Bane is really cool, really funky. Somehow simultaneously, like having a hugely overloaded healing kit. Like literally chain heal might be over healing too often, and like I'm almost afraid of it, like doing too much, which is like a weird way that it ends up nerfing itself. But chain heal is one of my favorite abilities in WoW on my like shaman, my like resto shaman. There was a brief moment in Wrath of Lich King when chain heal was like so nice. And I was lucky enough to play during then. So I have fond memories of chain heal, but this guy seems sweet. I start wanting to think of like MAM variants with him and like Malph Anduin in him. There's just other nature variants. That is the weird part, is that you kind of have to commit to this. You obviously want a Malfurion. And so like Malfurion, Bane, and what? Maybe Guff. I think that's my other instinct, is like you just take the biggest laser that you can and stick it onto just double support merc. But even Bane like throws down, like Bane does good damage. Just attacking for 12 is not nothing. And like you said, the huge 25 point big stomp sped up doesn't really matter that much. But no, I think Bane is really cool. Probably only like a four still, I would say, like a four to maybe 4.5. I don't think it's like crazy, but I think it's just a really cool one. And just for a rare, really sweet, goes with a lot of cool stuff.
For a rare, like
We've been begging for cool protectors, and he 100% fits the bill. So, big fan.
Yeah, no, it's a really cool one. I'm a fan, and this is one of the ones we've known as it was data mined early on. We didn't know much about it. Well, we finally get in the game. So, pretty cool stuff. We're all pretty high on that one, I think, for good reason. Then this one, another personal favorite, Maeve Shadow Song. I think our last legendary of the bunch. Yep. So. She is a protector, and she has some really, really unique abilities. Shout out to Charles, who apparently was the mastermind behind this one's design. I really love the design. It's incredibly, like, it just makes so much sense with the lore, and it also just seems like a very good unit. There was a little bit of a thing on the website where her cooldowns and speeds were not shown. First ability obviously has no cooldown. It's speed 5. And the other two each have one cooldown. And I think it is, 3 speed and then 10 speed, respectively. But yeah, she seems really good. The big thing I want to highlight from her is her passive. Your left and right most characters take 10 less damage from attack. So literally like inverse Illidan kind of super on theme. But one, you can, in theory, use this to protect herself, in theory, because it doesn't say other. Just as left and right. Also, knowing how the Illidan interaction with outcast attack works, she's the only one left. In theory, you can take 20 less damage because it's left and right. And the other thing I think is really, really sick about her, other than just like the fact that she wants to focus on a single target and get really big and damaging, but loses that if she switches, is you can literally just bounce a Merc to the bench and reset its cooldowns essentially by equal to the number of their benched Mercs. So it's all its abilities gain cooldown equal to the number of benched Mercs. So like if you do this, obviously it has one cooldown, you do this on turn two, they have a full bench, you're just throwing one of their Mercs to the bench. Obviously they could swap in something else, but if they have three Mercs on the bench, you just put three cooldown on all three of their skills. They literally can't send that Merc back in, or they can't use it, which is absurd. Yeah, the Mave is insane. I'm going to give this one easily solid 4, 4.5. I think it's one of the stronger characters, and I think you're going to see it in a lot of different builds.
Yeah, I think I would probably go with 4 for this one. Also, cool combo would be kind of like with Bran, if you did do it, where you can send like two mercenaries back.
So oh my god.
You just can't bring them out.
That would be insane. 10 damage yeah.
to Merc, it would go back onto the bench, and then you do it again. To a random Merc. So that would be kind of cool. But then also...
if it works.
Yeah, if it did. But also another one like Blink Fox, if you did do a reset, and then it would also be...
You can just keep throwing them back, yeah.
Yeah, mm-hmm. So that would be kind of cool. But yeah, I think I would go 4, because even just... You know, her basic ability is just like gain
just
10
good.
attack an enemy, and you keep the attack. It's not like
unless you swap,
it,
yeah.
Unless you hit someone else,
swap target.
So,
yeah,
yeah. I think it's really strong with that. So, yeah. Overall, I think I'd give her a solid 4 for this one.
All right.
Yeah, I think I obviously didn't know what the. I assumed there was an ability like in a cooldown on the imprison ability there.
Yeah, and only one though.
Yeah, no, it's that's not very much at all. Like she's basically she's never gonna die on turn one in that sense, right? Like if
no,
it's a
probably
it's
not
fast enough. I think she's good. I think
Rogers it on turn two, like you were saying with the other slow hunts, just boom.
Rogers wait,
get him out of there.
What speed is in prison again? Like 10?
10. It's very slow.
Right? Yeah, that's crazy. So yeah, I think she's good. I kind of had her a little bit lower again, just because it seems like in a weird way we almost got like a bunch of playable protectors now where
I know
like very protector light, and now she almost starts, in my opinion, I think she starts to get less powerful than some of the other protector options in specific tribes and stuff. So I honestly think she's only fine good. I think she's I'll give her like a 3.5 to 4.
Okay.
I think the attacking, I think a lot of times you're probably just going to end up having the like 5 more attack. And so she's just, you're treating her as like a 25 attack character essentially. And that's like a lot, obviously that is a good juicy number. But again, we've seen this precedent for Xuan and for other Mercs where like it is not good enough. But if Xuan had even a single other ability, which Maiev does.
Yeah.
Very different case. So I think I am really curious to see. I think Maiev's a really cool option for a Merc that is a protector that can go in just about any deck. And that was something we were really begging for. So maybe for that alone, that could bump it up to the 4 for me. But I think she's good. And I think if she's a cool legendary to open, like you're not mad about it. And she goes into a lot of, like you said, a lot of different decks. Whatever you were playing, you could totally try playing Maiev in it and opening with it. And it'll be good fun.
She has flexibility too. It's a little conditional, but that death blow, restore 25 health and gain the role of what you killed is kind of awesome. Like obviously it's not going to happen a ton, but the more abilities that have like weird role switching, the better.
And can she become neutral as well?
In theory, yeah. The only way to do that would be because you do gain the role. Well, minions, that's the kind of thing we learned. Minions do not have a role. Summons do not.
So she stays the same.
So if she kills a summon, yes. If she kills a neutral Cho, then she can become neutral. Ooh, that's our next character we're going to talk about. But yeah, I just think worth noting, really, I just love the role stealing and changing. And I hope we see more of it because I think it adds so much dynamic. Like, it makes mercenaries more of a, like, it makes it so the games aren't playing out the same all the time where it's like, I know these colors my opponents are bringing and I'll see what the units are and I'll go from there. Like, it just adds like more depth and more complexity, and I think that's a good thing. But yes, Cho, unless you guys had anything else you wanted to say about her.
No, all good.
All right. Cool. Yeah, we'll wrap it up because we're down to our last two. We're almost there. we can see the light at the end of the tunnel, and there's a Pandarian standing in the way. So we got Lorewalker Cho Epic Caster. I mean, our first Pandarian, which is pretty cool. Cho's really all about them summons. He cares a ton about summons, and he has a bunch of different summons he can make, and he has like different abilities and whatnot to help pay off those summons. I'm a little hesitant on if he's going to be good or not because of that, because summons have traditionally not been the craziest thing in the world on their own. And we also just got a ton of different interesting summons as well. So, but the big things where I think he has some potential are, he has a passive where your minions just take a flat 8 less damage, which seems insane. But that's just your minions. It's not your mercenaries. So,
yeah,
not quite crazy, but like good for summons. But the coolest ability by far, minus 10 health, battle cry, become neutral. So first neutral mercenary, really awesome. I mean, what are you going to do with that? We'll find out, but it fits Cho because Cho's not attacking directly. He doesn't care that he's a blue. He'd actually rather be neutral than nothing can crit him, and he lives longer. So, I mean, outside of a few fringe things where it always does a crit, or if you swap his rolls, and you can steal neutral from Cho if you have, like, Hook Dusk or Maeve or whatever, which is cool. And I think his Battle Cry might actually be kind of useful in some builds. Reduce all characters' attack by 20 this turn. You just throw, if your opponent's an attacking heavy comp and you throw that out off the bench, they're having a really sad turn next turn. Mm-hmm. Does hit your own characters, but if you're a caster focused build, you don't really care. So yeah, I think he's okay. Really interesting character, but I think lower on the power level scale, mainly because of the summon focus. So I'm going to put him in a little bit lower, probably around the 2.5 mark. Let's say like 2.5 because of the cool equipments, but I don't think he's going to be insanely powerful, but maybe there's a weird fringe build he shows up in.
Yeah, I had him also like pretty medium. None of the summons are really good enough. Like the summon 2 10-10s that are essentially 13-13s is, I think that's probably the maybe most underrated part. I mean, honestly, I think we might just be undervaluing the summons. I think even the 25 one is like, if you had a merc that had a delayed 25 damage, there's just really not other upside in the same way, which is kind of annoying. But I just to mirror what you were saying, yeah, that summons have basically been like only okay. Also, none of these, only one of them has rush that only attacks right away, and it's the worst of the summons. So that feels a little bit unfortunate, where it's just like, okay, now this is just like a worse Nazoth in terms of what it's doing every turn for the most part. But then with like the rest of your abilities aren't that great. They're kind of combo-y-ish. And again, it's good, like it's a cool like tribal card. In that sense, it's like very much printed for to be able to let people who want to have the all summons deck, you get to put Cho in your all summons deck because he summons more things. Combos like is your summon lord literally like from Magic, where it's like it affects everything of a certain card type, that's what Cho is for summons. Getting tons more summon support and interactions and crazy stuff with this set and Nazoth and things before it. So it's cool to see, but yeah, at the end of the day, I don't think it's that good. I think the only other thing that's worth anything is the reduce by attack by 20 battle cry might be very, very good.
Yeah.
I don't know. But it seems pretty likely. I mean, again, we did get a lot of new characters that don't really have to attack. Like even things like Hook Tusk and stuff, where like they're just shooting lasers and their actual attack stat doesn't matter very much. We also saw a lot of characters that like steal attack from things already. So maybe it's good at beating that. Maybe it's redundant in that sense. I'm not sure. But yeah, I only have him as like a 2.5 to 3-ish. Yeah. Again, it's in the summons deck, it's okay. But otherwise, the numbers are just a little too low, I think.
Yeah. So I'm going 5.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah. He is my favorite by far. I think he is. I am instantly maxing him. I see him as a bench carry for a lot of different comps. Think about him if basically Karen Diablo. Third ability, your character deals 5 more damage this turn. Fire stomps go to 11 per a hit. So if you do 11 right there, if you can like do the normal Diablo stomp, that's 4 times. That's 44 without crits.
Jeez.
Also, being neutral with only minus 10 health, I would even take it, honestly, if it was minus 25 health. Just because he doesn't have to attack at all.
Yeah, and having, no crits.
Yeah, so you don't have to worry about him hitting, and for people not critting, it's actually very hard to do 68 flat damage without crits. So yeah, he's not going to be able to just be bursted down and killed. Especially with patience too, I think you're going to basically be doing, you know, come off the bench, you do your wisdom, which gives you a big combo. Then you can do your patience and give just your other characters plus 5, plus 10, which is great survivability. And then summons, which the good thing of all three of them, they're all kind of like usable, especially if you're looking for endgame bench. You're going to know, okay, my opponent probably has these three mercs left. Which one's great? Do I want to have basically these like monkeys come out? Do I need a little bit of extra damage, maybe get a kill? Do I want to have it just a big 25 to hit next turn that they just can't kill or something? Mm-hmm. So I think that can be really great. Also, even his other equipment too. Just 20 attack from all characters. You just run him in a spell thing. But also, like as I was saying, for another combo, you could do him with local R and do it where local R gets to hit multiple times. So it's 10 hits right there. So without any frost damage stack, then it goes from 3 to 7. So it's 70 damage.
Jeez.
Just by that. And then also another thing, combo, if you get him, Bran, and Loke R, that's 140 damage combo of Loke if you double Loke's
Jesus.
Ability.
So that Loke already does that much damage by himself.
Yeah. Yeah. A little, I think it's a little win more.
But I'm saying, like, just without.
I get what you're saying. Like, I'll be honest.
The neutrality part is probably the most likely.
Yeah, because he's just going to stay alive.
I misunderstood this character. I think it's a result of the fast reading. I don't know why. It did not click in my head that his first ability is you choose one of those summons. I thought he just had all these summons as his abilities. Like, I think my brain just stopped reading the rest of it. So he's definitely better than I was giving him credit for. I'd probably bump him to at least a 3 because those other abilities are actually pretty sweet. I think the summons aren't that great, but the rest of him is pretty good. So I think I was underrating him. I wonder if I did that in the overview video, if I just skipped the last two abilities. Because I really thought it was just like, oh, well, he could do a one or these different summons. And I was like, wow, this is underwhelming. No, he's actually better than I thought.
Yeah, and I think, yeah, I'm instantly going for max on him and just going to run. I think Frost is going to be even way stronger with that.
Panda gang.
Just opening with frost characters that get the frost damage and then do local R, because I had a build before that was destroying where I went Varden, Drekthar, Belinda, and I had Varden get the plus frost equip, and then you would freeze 2 turn 1, Varden would get a bunch of frost damage, then Belinda on turn 2 would get a bunch, and then if you drop in like a local R already, that'd be good, but then if they kill 2, which sometimes they would do because that was the only way to like stop that combo, would be killing like the Varden and the Drekthar or something at the same time. So then if you can drop Cho in with Lokar, just it's a huge combo. So I'm definitely gonna go straight for him. Like, I think he's definitely gonna be like
cool
start a game. I don't think he's good, like, just with those.
No, he's like a bench carry.
He's never an opener, but I think he's gonna be a very, very strong bench carry. And I mean, there's a lot of abilities that have repeats in this game. Like, I checked in the Hearthstone client, there's like 20 mercs that have repeats.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, wow. So like any repeats, then that ability
gets nuts. Yeah, it's really nuts. That's cool. Yeah, all right, I respect it. You've convinced me a little bit that Cho is better than I thought. I didn't think he was terrible, but like reading his other abilities more, and I think you're spot on, bench carry for sure, not a lead. But yeah, Cho looks good. You convinced me a little bit. I'll give him a shot. We're down to the last one. Yeah, and the first panda. We actually get Pandarians, so like maybe more in the future. Cool. Last one. Final countdown. Yarel. So epic fighter, another holy unit. We need some more holy support, and I think this was a good choice. We needed something to go with Tyrael, and this is looking pretty good. I actually think this character is not insane, but not bad. Like, pretty good. I'd say I really like their second ability where you can it gains +6/+6, and then whenever a friendly character uses a holy ability, they gain +6/+6. So it's like Tyrion with his Blessing of Kings, except this has no cooldown, which seems kind of absurd to me at speed 4. Like, you could combo this with Velen, potentially. Velen wouldn't get buffed, but this could go off twice, and then he goes off after and gets two as well. There's some nutty combos you can do with this. And it's just the speed and everything, it's all holy. So we needed another good green holy unit to make Tyrael better, and I think this kind of fits the bill. And it's, again, much like Tyrael, all in on the holy skills, but I think that's okay for a tribe like this that really wanted more just holy-focused units. I think it's kind of reasonable. I also like that she got the, your characters have plus five shadow resistance. A lot of shadow stuff going around. I think shadow resistance is going to be a very real and a very strong thing. And then I like that there's a passive, like, end of turn. If you use two or more holy abilities, you gain two holy damage and two healing power. Yeah. That seems kind of nuts. Like,
That, I really like that equipment.
It's very, very good in a holy build, which I think is, we're kind of there. Like, I think we have enough decent holy characters now where we can do something. So I'm giving her like 3.5, maybe even 4, because I think the holy build's going to be good. And if it is, I think she's going to be a part of it. Or one of them, at least.
Yeah, I'm rating her very high, too. I'm going to go 4.5 on her. I think holy is definitely going to shoot up. Especially like with that Velen combo too, is you get the +6/+6, then if you do Velen, then he'll get the +6, and then like say you have any other holy like Anduin, he'll cast the ability twice, so then he'll get +12/+12. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, that's a lot of stats, but like I think Yarel and then like Tyrael, who's like attacking in, so you know you give her plus stats, Tyrael then will hit, freeze someone, and gain the stats. And then you could probably have, I think, Velen or Anduin, someone who's like healing both of your fighters back up, I think would be very strong. Or even a Cornelius, just stick.
Yeah,
Cornelius,
I think Corn, 100%. Like, little bit of anti-synergy there, because obviously you want to be going after that buff one. But, I mean it's kind of fine.
He could go first hit, gain more life, and then more stats, and then, because he is going fast, then turn two, then go for good heal and taunt.
The only downside, his attack skill is not holy, which is unfortunate.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
Maybe they'll add it, though, like Tyrian. They added Tyrian having first skill holy, so maybe they'll do that for Cornelius, too. But that's the only downside with Cornelius, but I think there could still be something there.
Yeah.
Because he's just so good.
Just keeping both your fighters alive as they swing in, so.
Yeah.
You can have, like, Anduin come off the bench and then do, like, a big heal or something, especially if she has healing power stacked also.
Yeah, I'd like Yarel also in my like good tier. I would put her probably like 3.5 to maybe 4. The opener, I think it's so close to being good enough to have Yarel, Tyrael, Anduin, the Velen on the bench, and then the other two can kind of be whatever you want. Literally, maybe even just like Karen Diablo, that kind of stuff. But you could go into some like backdoor ma'am kind of stuff. You could have like naturey bench, even if you want to get crazy, like the heal power, you could have a Malfurion on the bench. Like that might be kind of sick. So, and you could also literally have like Bane on the, in there, like loosely as well, and like start
more
getting,
heal
like,
power.
So
yeah.
There are these cool, like aggressive openers that have like these like combo healy back, like benches, literally Uther with the super like Avenging Wrath now.
Yeah, that can be good.
Holy characters you
like
have.
You can use Uther, so, like, with that.
Yeah. Velen stonks in general are like skyrocketing just by having literally like all of a sudden 2 to 3 times as many mercs where you actually care about doubling a spell, like doubling a holy spell, other than just, it was just Anduin's Holy Nova. That was literally the only thing that anybody ever copied. And now you have a lot of very good options. So I'm pretty high on Yarel. I think she's pretty sweet. I would put her, like 3.5 or 4. So I definitely, my holy, I can tell that I'll probably end up trying some like holy / nature slanted things, if any of the like Pokemon for me to choose at the end of it all. So
I think that's a great choice. Like you said, I think Bane and the nature just has some great healing components to it, and that has natural synergy with the holy. And I think there's some really cool stuff there. So we did it. A little round of applause here. We got through all 18 here. I'm happy we did this a little bit of a different format. Ended up working out time-wise. I know it is kind of late, though, so we are going to let Mulhu go. He has to get up early in the a.m. I think me and Wizard Beast will probably just go over like one little quick theory craft or two, and then I'll leave a link in the description, because on the patch reveal day, I ended up doing like almost a 6-hour stream of nothing but theory crafting.
Crazy. Yeah.
So we came up with just a bunch of stuff. I'm sure not all of it will be good, but I think at least some of it has some cool ideas and can be relevant and stuff. So we'll just take a look at, you know, just a build or two that you're thinking about. But yeah, overall, really love these new mercs. I cannot wait to start playing with them. Again, we're recording this literally the day of the patch notes, so it's dropping tomorrow for us, so we're very, very excited. And yeah, I can't wait to see what it does to the metagame. I'm hopeful that the stuff that we have got is enough to free us from the Trigor menace, at least in its current form of... I think there will be variety in this metagame, even if Trigor is still a strong character.
No, I think it's going to take the classic Hearthstone and like League style buff and nerf approach, where it's literally just like, if you give people cooler toys, even if Trigor is still good, people will play other stuff. And that alone, it's like nerfing a card. It's like, oh, I can dust this card. It's still good, but I can dust it for max value. I'm going to do it. I will literally play another deck. I don't care. And Hearthstone players have always responded that way, I think, with the way that their system of buffs and nerfs work. So I think definitely we will see Trigor fall down to a certain amount. But at the end of the day, if you want to play the Trigor deck, like, by all means, like, I urge you to try to, like, jam Trigor into the face of this. And let's see what happens. Let that be one of 10 playable decks, right? 100%.
Yeah, that's fine. Fine.
That is fine.
As long as it's not every deck, right? Like, that's really the issue. And also... way less RNG, which is phenomenal. Yeah, I think they were getting a little
RNG in literally anything.
Yeah, they were getting a little much with it, in my opinion, with some of the RNG effects. So I'm really happy we have a lot of things where the majority of them are just, you're making all the decisions. I want to make decisions in Mercenaries again, not watch decisions be made for me. So big props there. But yeah, we'll let you go, Mulhu. I know you got to be up early, but thank you for doing this with us. We'll see you next episode.
GG's.
Yes.
See you later.
Good luck. Adios, everybody.
Ready. So that is going to be like the bulk of the show here. We are just going to, I think we'll, do you want to do it where we'll each just talk once a little bit about like a build we think could be interesting or something like that? Does that sound good?
Yeah. Probably just like each do like one craft.
Yeah.
I think that should be fun.
All right, cool. I think I'm going to go with, for me, it's tough, but it's between two. They're two of my favorites from Theory Crafting stream. Mm-hmm. One involves a very large Chi-Gi, which I think can be really cool because I didn't get to play enough with Chi-Gi when he was kind of broken with the bug. So I want to try that out. But I think the one I'm most excited for is potentially a nature comp because Bane seems insane to me. And if you lead Elise, Bane, Malfurion, and you have that extra health and that healing power, you just heal a ton from the very beginning. And Elise is just like, even without the explorers, she's just like a good nature unit. You have the option for like, you can eventually work on the Golden Monkey and the Golden Monkey stuff. Two of the best abilities on there are nature ones. Like, you want to be like, your turn one is definitely going to be, you're buffing your characters by +5/+8 because Elise can use that attack. Bane can use that attack if he wants. And Malph, you just want it for the health. Like, you don't care about the attack. You'll get a little bit more damage.
Just keep healing everyone
up. Yeah, just like uber big health.
Scale it higher.
You have Cookie on the bench for more blue nature stuff, more HP. You're really going all in on your opener here, kind of. Like, you want your opener to be doing most of the work. And then on the bench, Cookie Brucon, kind of the cookie cutter, no pun intended, the cookie cutter nature stuff. I did consider Guff, and I think Guff is actually reasonable in a build like this, especially buffing him up with the Elise from the bench. So I think you could kind of pick your poison, Guff or Brucon. They both kind of work. I just wanted a blue to balance it out. But the last character that I think is going to be really sick in nature is Tide Mistress Thissa. This is another character where, for some reason, the gifts on the Nagas, a lot of them were like a little bit smaller than they actually are. Like, her gifts is 77. She actually has 79. small thing, but any extra HP helps. But mm-hmm. the big things with her, the nature weakness is really good, even though it's a frost ability. Riptide is strong and is nature and can proc multiple times. And the big one, though, Captive Tides, even if you don't have Nagas buffing it up, it's still pretty good off of the bench, I think, as just a nature ability. And you can also use her as, I think I like her as kind of protection off the bench with the summon, or just making sure your Riptide has more damage because you're all about that nature damage. I think they're both good options. But I think there really is something to a nature build. I'm not sure if going full nature will be the best way, or if it will be better to do like kind of the Chi-Gi stuff where you do Chi-Gi, Anacondra, Bane. So you're just like buffing up the Chi-Gi, and then you have the heal power from the start and you can gain more. And Anacondra heals and then buffs its max HP. Like, I think there's something there, because if your opponent doesn't have an opener that kills that quickly, I mean, you've seen it. You've played more Chi-Gi than I think most people. It just gets out of hand. Like, they can't do anything to deal with the bird. Like, and he just gets out of hand and just starts killing everything.
Yeah,
so,
as long as they can't one-shot him, if you have enough healing power, you can really just heal huge damage and heal again. It's like, I did have one time, like, a 1v4.
Yeah.
Just because I had enough heal power, I just ended up taking it just because they just couldn't kill me in one turn.
Yeah.
So,
no, it's sick.
Yeah, no, I think that could be really cool. And yeah, Chi-Gi was one of my favorite mercs until they murdered him, basically.
Yeah, but he might come back. I think there's enough support where we could see Chi-Gi rise from the ashes. Like, I think there really is a chance. There's enough in, like, there are enough ways, I think, now to protect him and naturally gain that that heal power and just good healing, where I think it's much, much more viable than the kind of limited pool of choices we had before. Like, I think it really is a pretty big buff to the potential he has, whereas before he was kind of riding the fact that his item was bugged, or not his item, his skill 3 was bugged, and it was doing too much damage. It was multiplying the value twice or whatever. But now, I think even without that, I think he could start seeing play again. So here's hoping for you. He comes back into it. But that's the build I want to focus on. I really like it. I think there's, you know, we haven't seen even nature as a bench in a little while now. It just got kind of hated out of the meta. Which we saw happen to other builds, right? Nature was around for forever. It's like, it's up there with Karen Diablo as like the classic bench. And right now it's gone. I don't think that's going to remain the case. I think nature, not only can it come back as potentially a slightly different bench comp, but I think it can be like a full-on nature build. There's just enough support now. So that's the one I'm excited for. Again, I'll have a link in the description where I have all the theory crafts that we put together on the stream, but, what about you, Wizard Beast? What are you kind of thinking about? What do you want to like jump into day one? I know you're really excited about Cho.
Yeah, Cho for sure. But for opener, like, so for the full comp, the more we've been kind of going through this, I really want to try League of Explorers. I think doing full just stats of just,
they get
like,
huge.
You know,
Elise can be like gigantic.
Yeah, I know. Between having all of her buffing the other ones, and then Brandon buffing them all, and then you have nature, or not nature resistant, you have frost, fire, and shadow resist.
Yeah.
So it's just like, oh, they're going to try and kill me. I have a ton of life, and I'm reducing their damage, basically. So I really want to try that. Just have huge stats, and then like basically use Reno basically as just like a massive taunt shield.
Yeah.
And then do the death rattle, of course.
It's our caster protector, kind of, right?
Yeah, so and I think it. Yeah, I love his diamond too. His
it's
diamond
so cool.
They do a great job on all of the diamond artworks.
Just all the portraits in general. Like, I'm honestly like blown away by some of the art in these. Like, I legitimately cannot wait to crack open those packs I've been holding for like 2 months. It's really gonna be. And again,
yeah, it's gonna be fun tomorrow.
So many characters we don't have to worry about. Like legendaries. It's not like five or ten of them are legendaries and we're not going to get half the portraits for them for forever.
Yeah, it's like three of them that we need to get like at least open. So
yeah, that's and, cool. And and you know, we get those rare portraits pretty easily unless you're named zombies and happen to want a Yulon.
But got any, really, Nefarian.
Oh my god, that's so crazy.
He's the rare that I haven't got anything for. So
you know how it feels. Yeah, yep. It's hopefully in this draft, right? We'll crack open those packs and hopefully we will get all that stuff. But again, we're doing this the day of the patch notes, so this is all fresh in our mind. We have not seen any of these characters in action yet, and realistically, you probably won't see a ton of them for at least the first week, probably a little bit longer. It is going to be like Mull, who said, pick your Pokemon, right? No, I mean, even like the hardcore of the hardcore grinders, you can't grind 18 mercenaries in a incredibly short time span. I just don't think you could be going at 24/7. It's going to take time.
One a day, it will take 18 days.
So. I know, right? But luckily, that task increase is going to help us along a bunch. Because I remember when Localar came out, I spent most of the day getting farming up his tasks and getting. It was just a pain, you know. We had to get the stranger every time, 18 times. It was a little more common back then, but you could still get screwed by it. So, and then I did Nazoth recently, and I did it in an afternoon. Like I did it over like 2-ish hours or something. It was so much faster, and that was just doing his solo. If we have like 2 or 3 or 4 of the new Mercs things all at once, you can just get them done at the same time. Like, so
having it all at level 1 tasks too, so it's easy to line them all up. Because, you know, before, like, I bet a bunch of people have, you kind of like maybe did a couple, and you know, because it's only like one for each that you're getting randomly, so you might have like a 9, a 2, and like a 16 or something.
So,
I've gotten most of my tasks done. I've been finishing more and more. I'm actually about to finish Nazoth's probably tonight. I'm on like task 15 with him. So
nice.
Probably only have like 20 that don't have their tasks all the way done. So getting closer, but not exactly in time for the drop, but it'll be cool.
Same here. I try. It's hard. It's hard to do them all.
The only thing that kind of sucks is we'll get the daily reset technically when everything drops. So like we'll get it all tomorrow. So we won't get any tasks for the new ones tomorrow.
There's a workaround for this, and it's going to be too late for our viewers by the time they're hearing this. But someone dropped some hot knowledge on me in chat that I did not know about. So as you know, the tasks reset when daily quests reset, right? 3 in the morning, EST 12 PST. Well, it turns out, I believe this is true, where your mercenaries' tasks do not refresh until you go into the mercenaries' area. You click the mercenaries' button, and then they pop up. So what you can do if you want a chance at new mercenaries' tasks tomorrow, you have to be careful about it, because you can't go in there to buy packs. You have to open like 5 or 10 stored packs so you get the rares and maybe an epic or two. And then if you enter the mercenaries area, you have a chance of getting those new mercenaries right off the bat, because even though it resets at the reset time, apparently you do not get the task until you actually open the mercenaries thing in the client. So you can just
fire pit and everything.
And you can just go to the pack section of regular Hearthstone, open like 5 or 10 mercenaries packs, get your rares, and now you have a chance to not even have to farm stranger on the day of. So I mean, people on stream heard it, so I got the word out there a little bit, but if you're hearing it now, it's probably a little late, but now you know for next drop.
The only thing about that, though, is if people wanted to buy bundles, you can't, like,
yes, that's the only downside.
Us in the mercenaries mode.
Check the Discord. People will post.
Yeah, that's true.
And you don't even have to open all your packs. Just, like, literally just open enough to get a few rares. Like, that's it.
Which is, like, what?
Because it'll save you a lot of time. So, well, if you have all the rares already, you're guaranteed. So, like, you just open, like, 5 packs or something. You got 5 rares. A little bit more.
How many rares are there in this drop? Because there's 5 legendaries.
So, if there are 5 legendaries, it's probably split either 6 rares, 7 epics, or 7 rares. Probably 7 rares, 6 epics. I didn't count it out, but I think it's about evenly split. I wouldn't be surprised. I think Epic might have 7, but
There's 5 rares.
Only 5 rares, okay.
Yeah, okay, so there's 8.
So more Epics, yeah.
Yeah.
Still, so open 5 packs, you have a, and then go into the Mercenaries thing, and you will have a higher chance at getting the tasks, which will save you a lot of time farming the Mysterious Stranger, because he can be a little bit of a pain to find now sometimes.
Yeah, no, I think it'll be really cool though to have it all of the stuff dropping tomorrow. So,
oh hell yeah,
seeing all that come out, and
then we get the Nazoth event in like a week, or I mean it'll almost be out by the time this goes up. So it's awesome, and I think I don't want to speak too soon, but I do think we are going to see a bit more regular events to help with mm-hmm. that time in between releases. Obviously, this release is probably going to keep us busy for a good while, but I think the events are a great way to help out with that. And we know from Charles that Red Murloc's coming, and yep. it wasn't in the big drop, so you'd imagine it's got to be coming in event, especially since Finley's the only explorer we didn't get. Like, mm-hmm. it's just got to be. And Reno, I think, is the one who says you're explorers. It doesn't specify specifically Bran or Elise like the others do. Like, it's going to be, I think he's coming for sure. There's no way they'd leave him out, especially when he was like a feature of the Sunken City. But yeah, I think that's going to wrap it up for us for episode, I think we're 22, episode 22 of the Fighting Pit here. At this point, if you're watching, you probably know where to find us, but there are links in the description in case you do not. And yeah, if you enjoyed it, like, comment, subscribe, all that good stuff. Helps with the algorithm, helps the show. Really do appreciate it, but this was really fun. Let us know what you thought of the little bit of a different format. I think for these big drops, it's better just to like talk about our feelings about it and not read every line on the thing, because this podcast probably would have been 2 hours longer if that were the case, and it's already almost 3 hours long. So but yeah, it was a lot of fun. Thanks to Wizard Beast and Mulhu for joining me as always, and hopefully in the next sometime in the next few weeks or something, we'll maybe see about getting another guest or two on here now that we got some more mercenary stuff to talk about. I can't wait to talk early metagame stuff, and I'm just looking forward to seeing how it all develops. So definitely stay tuned for that. But that is going to do it for episode 22 of The Fighting Pit. Well, thank you so much for watching, and we will catch you in the next one.
Peace. Yep, see you guys on the next one. Stay safe.